September 17th, 1996. The interviewee is General Felix Sparks. Interviewer, Tony Catch Binstock. The interview is being done in Denver, Colorado, USA, and is being done in English. My name is Tony Catch Binstock. It's September 17th, 1996. Today I'm honored to be interviewing General Felix Sparks. The interview is being conducted in Denver, Colorado, United States of America, and is being done in English. Would you give me your name and the spelling, please?
My name is Felix L. Sparks. First name is F-E-L-I-X, L, middle initial. Last name is Sparks, S-P-A-R-K-S.
And was that your name at birth?
Yes.
Have you been known by any other names or nicknames?
My middle name is Lawrence, so I'm usually referred to by my middle name, and most people call me Larry.
And your birth date, please?
August 2nd, 1917.
And what is your age today?
79.
And would you give me the city and the spelling of the city and where you were born?
Well, I was born in San Antonio, Texas. S-A-N is two words. S-A-N, second word is A-N-T-O-N-I-O, Texas.
And that's United States of America?
Yes.
Do you remember your address?
No, I do not. And I was a little young at that time.
Tell about your growing up. Where did you grow up?
Well, when I was about 4 years old, we lived in Texas until I was about 4 years old. And my family moved to Arizona, and I actually grew up in Arizona. I went to school there from grammar school to college in Arizona.
What was the name of the town or city where you lived?
I lived in Miami, Arizona, which is a mining town, copper mining town, about 80 miles east of Phoenix, Arizona.
Tell about your family, your father and what he did, and your mother.
Well, my father worked for the mining company, Inspiration Copper Company. My mother never worked. When I was growing up, mothers did not work. But my father worked most of his life with Inspiration Copper Company.
And how many brothers and sisters do you have?
I have one brother and three sisters, all younger than I am.
You were the oldest?
I'm the oldest.
And would you give us their names, please?
Well, my brother's name is Earl Sparks. My sister, oldest sister, Liddell Sparks. Next is Francis Sparks, and the youngest one is Margaret Sparks.
And what was the community like in which you lived?
Well, it was a mining community, and mining communities are, some people think they're a little rough. I thought it was perfectly normal myself. But the entire economy depended upon the copper mines. There was no other industry of any kind in that area. So your whole livelihood was based upon the copper mines.
Do you remember the names of the schools that you attended?
Yes, I attended. The grammar school that I attended was George Washington Grammar School in Miami, Arizona. That was an 8th grade school. After I graduated from there, I attended the Miami High School for 4 years.
Did your family attend church?
Yes, we attended the First Baptist Church in Miami, Arizona.
And that what denomination?
Baptist.
Did you know much about Jews or Judaism growing up?
Nothing.
Were there any Jewish people in your town?
Yeah, there were a few, but very few. There was no synagogue. I doubt if there are more than half a dozen Jewish people. Because when you're growing up, you don't pay much attention to that. But I don't recall any Jewish people at all, to tell you the truth. But I would not have paid any attention had I known.
Were you aware of any prejudice against blacks or Jews or anything?
The prejudice that I experienced was against blacks and against Mexicans. Arizona's on the borders the Republic of Mexico. So we had a great many people who migrated into Arizona from Mexico, and there was considerable discrimination practiced against them. We only had two or three black families, and nobody paid much attention to them, but they were discriminated against in that there was one small school for blacks, of which there were only two or three students, and they attended grammar school in a one-room schoolhouse. However, when they graduated from that, they could go to the regular high school. And I only knew one black student all my time in high school. There was one black girl in my class, and she was the only black in the high school.
And if there were Jews, you weren't aware?
I wasn't aware of them, no.
And were you and your family involved in any community organizations?
No.
And what were your hobbies growing up?
Well, I did a lot of fishing and hunting. And we were in a mountainous country, and I wandered around, climbed mountains, and played a lot of baseball as kids. And there wasn't a lot to do. We didn't have any money, for one thing. So the kids pretty well had to entertain themselves.
And after high school, then, did you attend college?
No. While I was in high school, at the end of my freshman year, the mines closed down. The Great Depression of the 1930s had started. So the economy throughout the United States suddenly collapsed for no good reason. And the mines closed, and my father was out of work. Well, we got by. My father finally got back on with the company after they'd laid him off for a while, and he, I think, got about $80 a month as a watchman in one of the mines. So when I graduated from high school, I didn't have any way to go to college. I had no money, so I joined the Army for a 3-year enlistment.
What year was that?
It was in 1936.
And what were your goals and aspirations before you...
Well, I wanted to go to college. I wanted to be a lawyer. But there was no way. I didn't have a dime. No way I could do it. So I figured if I could join the Army for 3 years and you could save my money, I could start college. And that's exactly what happened.
Tell about those years in the military.
Well, when I went in the Army in 1936... the Army was extremely small. Not much attention had been paid to the military since the days of World War I. So the Army was quite small, and I was sent to Hawaii as a member of an artillery regiment at Pearl Harbor. We were part of the harbor defenses of Pearl Harbor. Military training was rather harsh. And the pay wasn't much. As a private, we got $21 a month. But I got promoted pretty rapidly. I worked hard. And I really enjoyed the years that I spent in the Army in Hawaii. And at least it gave me the opportunity to save up enough money to make a start in college. And it didn't take much money in those days to go to college.
So you were in the Army from 36 to 39, the 3 years?
To 38. In Hawaii, it was considered foreign service in those days. So if you signed up for foreign service, you could get out of the Army in a little over 2 years. So I only spent a little less than 2.5 years in the Army. And then I got out in time to start college in the fall of 1938.
And where did you attend college?
University of Arizona, at Tucson, Arizona.
And did you get married at that time, or were you still in school? Or
no, I started school and went 2.5 years when I got a notice that I had been called back into the Army. In the meantime, I had secured a commission as a second lieutenant infantry. through a combination of ROTC and what was called a Citizens Military Training Camp. So I got a commission as a second lieutenant. And in December of 1940, I received a notice to report to the Army for a period of 1 year. The draft had then started, so they were trying to fill out the Army with draftees and with reserve officers. I was then a reserve officer. So I went back into the Army then in January of 1941.
And tell about that, your career in the military at that time.
Well, I was assigned, I had to report to Fort Huachuca, Arizona, which is down on the Mexican border. And from there I was assigned to the 45th Infantry Division, which was a National Guard division which had been mobilized in September of 1940. But they were considerably short of personnel. So I was assigned to the 45th Infantry Division while I was at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And specifically, I was assigned to the 157th Infantry Regiment, which is one of the regiments of the 45th Division. And that was the beginning of that one-year assignment, which presumably turned out to be over 5 years, because before my year was up, Pearl Harbor came along, and of course, then the general mobilization started. And so I spent 5 years with that regiment.
Where were you in Pearl Harbor?
I was a student at the infantry school at Fort Benning, Georgia. This was a school conducted by the Army for infantry officers. It was ran about 3 months, 4 months. And I happened to be a student there at the time of Pearl Harbor. And my year was going to be up the following month. So I thought I was going to be getting out of the Army. Instead, I remember that Sunday morning, we got the news by radio. That was before TV. That the Japs had hit Pearl Harbor. And we all knew that we weren't going to get out in a year. So we geared up then for wartime service. And I returned to my unit, which was on at Camp Barkley, Texas. And from there on, we went to various places in the United States and were finally sent to North Africa in June of 1943. At that time, I was a captain.
Well, before we go into the wartime experience, tell about, you were married sometime between?
Yes, I met my wife. She started at the University of Arizona the same time I did, so we were in the same freshman class. At that time, the university was fairly small. I mean, I think we had about 800 freshman students. Today it's about 8,000, but at that time it was a fairly small university. And we met and we started going together until I got called into the Army. And after I got called into the Army, I got to thinking about it and I missed her. So I called her one day from Abilene, Texas, where I was stationed, and said, "Let's get married." She agreed. I said, "Okay, you work out the details, and I get a leave, and I'll come to Tucson, Arizona, and we'll get married." Well, that was in June of 41. That was before Pearl Harbor, so we didn't know at the time we got married that I was going to have to spend another over 4 years in the Army. Anyway, we were married, been married ever since.
Did she follow you to different camps?
Yes, she did. She went with me to the various camps. We were stationed in Massachusetts, then New York, and then Virginia. And from Virginia, then, we went overseas, and she came home.
And were any children born before you went overseas?
Well, the first child was born while we were in the shipping area in Virginia, in Norfolk, Virginia. So our first child was born at that time, and I never, of course, never saw the child. The child was born in Arizona, and the child was 2.5 years old before I ever saw him. It was a boy.
And his name?
Kirk. Okay.
And what year was he born?
He was born in 1943.
And then you were going to tell us about your wartime experiences. Were there any Jews in your unit, in your command at all?
Oh, yes. There were a considerable number of Jewish people in the Army at that time, and quite a number in our regiment and division. Matter of fact, at division headquarters, there was a Jewish rabbi.
And was there any discrimination?
No.
In the service at all?
It was kind of a grim period for all of us. We didn't have time to discriminate. We depended on each other. When you're in combat, you have a team. And each team member has to do his part. So there was a remarkably little discrimination, if any, that I could determine. We had Mexican boys, we had some Indians. We did not have any blacks in our unit, but we had others like Spanish Americans, Indians, Jewish, you name it. And there was no discrimination.
Before you went overseas, did you have any idea about what was going on in Germany and with the Jews?
Very little. I, of course, read the papers, but we didn't get much information at that time, the American people, about what was actually happening in concentration camps. There was virtually no information.
Was there anything in the military publications?
No, nothing at all.
And then you were going to tell us about when you did go overseas. Where did you go first?
Well, we shipped out of Norfolk, Virginia, and went to North Africa and made a practice landing. The campaign in North Africa had just ended a short time before we got there. So we didn't actually participate in any combat in North Africa. But we made a practice landing, a salt landing, on the shores of North Africa and practiced for the invasion of Sicily. So we were in North Africa just a short time, a couple of weeks, and then we loaded back up on our ships, and we were one of the assault units that hit the shores of Sicily in July of 1943.
Describe what that campaign was like.
Well, it was, we were new to combat, very green, but all the troops performed quite well. And it took us about 30 days to clear the island of German troops. So there were some pretty hard-fought battles, but it did not last long. And our casualties were fairly light, but at least we got a lot of valuable combat experience in that 30-day period until the Germans actually pulled out of Sicily into Italy. We then followed them. We made then the invasion of Salerno, which was a very bloody operation where we lost a lot of people because the Germans were waiting for us at Salerno. Salerno is an area just south of Naples. And we fought there for almost a full week trying to establish a beachhead in the Salerno area. And finally we succeeded. From there on then, we pursued the Germans through Italy up till near Rome, where the Germans finally established a defensive position. They were not able to penetrate for about 6 months.
And that was about what time of year then?
Well, we had landed in Salerno in September of 1943, and by about Christmas time or a little before of 43, the Germans had established a very tough defensive line based on Monte Cassino across the Liri Valley, which is just maybe 30 miles or so south of Rome. At that point, our drive bogged down. Starting about the 1st of December, our problem was compounded by a lot of rain. It rains in Italy in the wintertime. And the rivers rose. We had difficulty crossing the rivers, and the steep mountain terrain made it very difficult to attack. So the Germans were well dug in, And we could not make any, we didn't make any progress after about the 1st of December until the following May. Almost 6 months we were stymied there until we built up enough strength to finally crack that Gustav line in early May of 1944.
Were you, what was your rank then?
Well, I was a captain. I was a rifle company commander. I had Company E of the 157th Infantry. I was wounded in Italy fairly seriously, an abdominal wound which got part of my liver, and I was in a hospital for over a month in North Africa, and I was wounded in late October, did not return until December of 43. From there on, then, I was a rifle company commander up until, including the invasion of Anzio. A decision was made to try to take Rome by landing near Rome at a small port town called Anzio. And our division, along with the 3rd Infantry Division and 2 British divisions, were given a task of making that landing and taking Rome. We landed, but we didn't take Rome. Not for several months.
How were you wounded?
A shell fragment. Most casualties during the war were caused by artillery. Artillery is the biggest casualty-producing agent. Now, the obvious reason is when a shell lands a reasonable distance from someone, that shell fragments into hundreds of pieces. So one shell may get 10 people, whereas a rifle bullet can only get one at a time, but a shell can get 10 or 15 people at a time. So I would say during the war that probably 75% of all of our casualties and about 75% of all the German casualties were inflicted by artillery and mortars. Mortars have the same effect as artillery.
Did you ever, your unit ever capture any German prisoners at that time?
Oh, we took prisoners. We took the first prisoners in Sicily. We took some in Italy. In France, we took a great number of German prisoners.
Well, finish telling us about where you went after Anzio and Rome.
Well, after the Anzio campaign, which was a very bitter campaign, we were bogged down there for almost 4 months. We lost over 100% of our original strength, our regiment did, well, every unit that went in there. It was over 100% turnover. Our casualties were over 100%, which means that we had new replacements coming in all the time. But finally, we made the break out of Anzio and took Rome. That was in May of 1944. Our division was then pulled out of the lines and sent back to Naples in order to make the invasion of southern France. The Normandy invasion took place in June 6, 1944. 2 months later, the Allies invaded southern France. At that time, I was a battalion commander and commanded a battalion then, an infantry battalion, when we made the assault on the shores of southern France.
Were you there then on D-Day?
Yes. I was H plus 10, which meant that my job was to get ashore 10 minutes after the first wave. We have a first wave hits at HR, which was probably about 5:30 in the morning or 6. 5 minutes later is the second wave. Another 5 minutes is the third wave. And the orders were that the battalion commanders had to come ashore as rapidly as possible in order to get control of their units. An amphibious operation is a very difficult operation because you're landing on hostile shores and the enemy, you're facing an enemy that's already dug in, and you're relatively naked because you're getting out of small boats and rushing at them. So the senior commanders have to get ashore rapidly in order to get control of their units and determine how you're going to assault the German positions. So yes, all the battalion commanders came ashore at 10 minutes after each hour. And I was one of those battalion commanders. I think I was 25 years old at the at the time.
And then describe what was that like for you?
Well, it was, we'd been in combat then for over a year, so we took it in stride. We had planned, we had extensive planning before the invasion. We knew about what we were up against, where we were going to land, and what the obstacles were. So it went off surprisingly well, because the Germans had pulled a lot of troops out of southern France because of the Normandy invasion. So they were undermanned. The Germans were undermanned. And we had figured somewhere around 20% casualties for the landing. It actually turned out that we had less than 5%, which was very remarkable. Our casualties were very light. But when I speak about light casualties, they're not light for the people who got hit or who were killed, but we had less than 5%, which to us was a smashing success. And then we drove on inland fairly rapidly, and we started then capturing literally thousands and thousands of German troops that we cut off.
What happened to those troops then? Where did they go?
Well, of course, as we rounded up, the Germans, they had some very poor troops. They even had some Russians fighting that they had got to fight for them. A Russian battalion that I ran into, that was actually Mongols, what they call a Mongol battalion. They didn't want to fight, and they gave up to my battalion right off. So we captured a Mongol battalion without firing a shot. We just sent them on back to the rear. But the Germans' defenses really started getting tough as we moved further into France, and particularly when we hit the Vosges Mountains. It's a very mountainous area between, runs along the German-French border in northern France. And at that time, then, the fighting became very bitter and very expensive from there on. Heavy casualties on both sides throughout the winter of 44 and 45.
We're going to end this tape and continue on the next one. September 17th, 1996. The interviewee is General Felix Sparks. Interviewer Tony Catch Binstock. Interview is being conducted in Lakewood, Colorado, USA, and is being conducted in English. And we were talking about your wartime experience, General, and I just wondered, did you ever hear any Nazi propaganda, Axis Sally?
Yes. When we were going overseas from Norfolk, Virginia to North Africa, we actually went to Oran, North Africa, which is in Algeria. We had a very large convoy, of course. Our division, well, there were five ships just in our regiment, so that were needed to carry just our regiment. So we had, with a naval escort, we probably had 50 vessels of one type or another, large convoy. On the way over, we kept getting over the radio these messages from Axis Sally. But we thought they were very amusing. I recall she kept saying, one day she said, "Now, boys, the Germans identified us correctly." We were a little surprised, but Anyway, she came on and said, "We know you boys from 45th Infantry Division are sailing for North Africa." And she said, "Now, boys, it's very sad, and I'm very sad to do this, but I'm going to sing a song. I'm going to play a song for you. And the song is The Last Roundup." And they had that American song, The Last Roundup. So she repeated that several times. And she had all kind of propaganda. We hardly ever got the chance to listen to radio, of course, but on the naval convoy, we didn't have anything to do, so we could listen to radio. When we were in combat, we didn't have any radio. I mean, we had radios, but not just for our own communication. But it took us a little over 2 weeks to go from Norfolk to North Africa. And she entertained us the whole time. We thought it was hilarious. I guess she thought she was making some impression on us, but we thought it was funny.
And then let's get back. You started to tell about the battle in southern France and how difficult that got. Would you continue about that?
Yes. The southern France battle, it wasn't bad till we got some miles inland, over 100 miles inland, and running into the Vosges Mountains. And the Vosges Mountains are very rugged, heavily timbered. And we're running into winter then. Winter descended upon us, and there was a lot of snow and rain, and the weather was very cold, and it was very difficult to fight against to attack the German fortified positions, because they had time to dig in. So we just slogged it out. We took casualties every day. Maybe in my battalion I would take a mountain, take me all day to take a mountaintop, and the next day I had to do the same thing and the next mountain. And it was very discouraging because we took very, very heavy casualties and the weather was absolutely miserable. All the soldiers were miserable. And we were not getting many replacements in. So we were getting under strength, and sometimes we were in line for fighting for over 60 days with no relief at all. The American Army was getting stretched pretty thin then because of the advance to our left and as a result of the Normandy invasion. And we were just running short on men. And then we had the war going on in the Pacific as well. So the American Army was stretched pretty thin. So it was a thoroughly miserable and costly campaign that we put on to getting to the German border from our initial landing. We lost, in my regiment alone, we lost several hundred men. And I lost several hundred in my battalion. But in December of, just the day before Christmas in 1944, my battalion pushed into Germany. And I wasn't the first. There were other American units that had already crossed the day before. But in my attack zone, I crossed the day before Christmas. And we got into Germany then, in the next few days, several miles, and we thought we were finally cracked the worst of it. But then came the Battle of the Bulge. The Germans made a desperate attempt to break through the troops on them, which were way over to our left, attacking through Belgium.
Excuse me.
And that stalled everything, and we had to pull some troops out of our army to send over to help the troops that were being attacked on our left. So we were stripped of troops to try to reinforce the bulge. And that bulge was finally stopped by Christmas, actually. It would, right after Christmas, it was pretty well stopped. But then the Germans made a second attack in our sector, which they called Operation North Wind. And we had a new division that had just come over from the States up in the Vosges Mountains, and the Germans attacked that division and pushed it back some 5 or 10 miles. So suddenly I got an order. I'm up in Germany now, and that I had to pull back because we were fairly exposed. Our division was up there by itself in Germany. So the whole division was ordered back and immediately ordered to counterattack the German penetration. So I got back one afternoon from Germany by trucks and hit the German penetration the next morning. That was in January of 45. And that was the most costly battle of the war for our regiment. We hit the German penetration head on, and they had some good troops. They had some SS troops that they had just brought in from Norway. And well-equipped, well-trained, and we were at about half strength and exhausted. Anyway, we fought there for a week in those mountains, and the Germans didn't gain another inch. But on the other hand, we paid for it dearly. Our regiment, we lost 5 full rifle companies. Now you have 9 companies in the regiment. We lost 5 full companies in that battle, along with elements of others. So we paid very dearly. We were decimated, but the Germans did not gain any further. That was the worst battle of the war for us, by far.
What did that do to you and your troops?
Well, I was... That hurt badly because I lost 3 of my companies, all 3 of my rifle companies. So out of what normally would be 1,000 men, I had less than 200 left. When we got the German drive stopped, then a new division came in and relieved us. They didn't really have to do anything. They just took over our positions. We were pulled back and got, I was given about 2 weeks to formulate and train a new battalion to go back into combat. But that was one of my darkest moments because I lost a lot of good men in that week battle. But in 2 weeks, new recruits started coming in, and I had to formulate and get new officers, new company commanders, new sergeants. And it was a frantic job trying to get organized an infantry battalion again in about a 2-week period. But we did it, and we went back into the lines again. That's the way war works. After that, then, we finally fought through January, February, and the Germans were weakening all the time. And in March, then, the whole Allied armies, March of 45, all the Allied armies made a major push into Germany. Many were already, over our left, they were already in the edge of Germany. In our area, we attacked in March, and we didn't stop. We ordered, keep moving, keep moving, keep moving. Don't let the Germans get reformed, reorganized. So we even went, in some cases, we went 24 hours a day. Day and night. This was needless to say, it was tremendously exhausting. We used searchlights at night to see. And we made several night attacks using searchlights to keep the Germans off balance. And it was very successful. We had a bitter battle in the Siegfried Line, a heavily defended line that the Germans had built. But we broke in our sector, we broke it in 1 day. But again, we took some pretty heavy casualties. A couple of days later, we crossed the Rhine River. By that time, the Germans were pretty badly disorganized. And in my sector, I crossed the Rhine and using assault boats furnished by the Corps of Engineers. And we had almost no opposition on the Rhine. So we crossed quite easily, drove on into deep into Germany then, and kept driving. The only major battle we had after the Rhine River was at a city called Aschaffenburg, Germany, which was on the main river, which is a tributary of the Rhine. And there we ran into a fanatical group of Germans who were defending the city. And it took us a week to clear the city. And we took some pretty heavy casualties, but nothing like the Germans did. They took probably 5,000 casualties. We had, in my battalion, I had about 200. And in my battalion and the other two battalions of the regiment cleared Aschaffenburg, but it took us a week. And as I say, it was hard fighting. Village or town fighting is always difficult because it's very close. You see, you go around the corner and you're being shot at from a window or a cellar, basement. So the fighting is very close. It means that when you get hit, you usually hit at very close range. And that's the case where most of the wounds then are caused by rifles. You can't use artillery to amount to anything in a city. It's almost, artillery is almost useless if you're actually fighting in there. So you have to do it by hand. It's a hand operation. That means grenades and rifles. And that was pretty costly, but there was a German garrison of about 5,000 people, and with less than that, we overcame it in a week's time. From there on, then, we moved fairly rapidly towards Nuremberg, and the Germans then made another stand at Nuremberg. See, all this time, I'm a lieutenant colonel, I'm a battalion commander at that time. In Nuremberg, we had some tough resistance for like one day, but it took us 2 or 3 days. That's a large city. It took us 2 or 3 days to clear it. I had very few casualties, probably not more than 20 in my battalion in Nuremberg, very light casualties. But we captured several thousand Germans there. And right outside of Nuremberg then, as we were, the whole army was regrouping to make, our objective was the city of Munich. That was the 7th Army, one of the 7th Army objectives. Because that was the capital city of Bavaria. And we were, Nuremberg, we were operating in Bavaria. And that was considered to be the transportation, supply, and command hub of Bavaria. And therefore, it was a critical objective as far as the 7th Army. Our division was part of the 7th United States Army. On our left was the 3rd United States Army. And our mission was to get to Munich as rapidly as possible before the Germans had a chance to consolidate defensive positions. Right outside of, as we left Nuremberg, the day before we departed, I was designated as a task force commander and given a battalion of tanks with my infantry battalion, plus 2 artillery batteries and some engineers. And the tanks, with a battalion of tanks, that's about 54 tanks. And my orders were to proceed as rapidly as possible towards Munich, to bypass any opposition if I got too much opposition, and that following forces would clean it up. But I was to barrel into Munich as rapidly as I could. Well, of course, with these tanks, I had all the tanks that the division had. They only had one battalion. So I divided it up into 2 prongs. My executive officer took one prong, I took the other. And then we just smashed whatever we ran into. We had such tremendous firepower. The Germans just only put up, they would blow bridges and defend places like that. But we had so much firepower that, and we had the engineers coming up, bridging the rivers for us in fast order. The American Corps of Engineers was remarkably organized for helping the combat troops. And they could put a bridge across a very large river in a fairly short time. And so wherever we ran into problems, I'd get infantry across the river to protect the engineers, and they would come up and put their bridge across, and then I could get my tanks. Well, this continued in for several days, and we were cutting off, like 50 miles a day. That is until my tanks ran out of gas, actually, and they would have to stop and refuel. Until, on the evening of April 28th, 1945, I was about 30 miles or a little less from Munich. So I geared up to make the attack towards Munich, got my tanks refueled by midnight, and we were going to take off at daylight. I'm running into very little German opposition, just a few roadblocks, and it took us, usually 20, 30 minutes to wipe out what was on our way, and then we were on our way again. Well, that night I got a word over our radio system that the Dachau concentration camp was in our zone of action the next day. And this information was sent to all units, not just to me, all units in the 7th Army that happened to be in my zone of attack. And the information was that if we went into the Dachau, that it was a politically sensitive area. That's the way it came over the radio. Well, that didn't mean a damn thing to me, really. I didn't pay a whole lot of attention to it because my mission was to take Munich.
You didn't know what a concentration camp was?
No, I didn't know what a concentration camp was.
Excuse me.
I'd never heard of it. Neither had any American soldier. So we assumed from the word, of course, that there were concentration, that there were prisoners there. But we had absolutely and utterly no information in the American Army about concentration camps. It might have been some at higher headquarters, but I doubt it because none of it was ever disseminated, at least, to the troops. So I didn't pay much attention to that, to tell you the truth. And the next morning, I looked on my map and I saw where the concentration camp was, right outside of the city of Dachau. So I had my left force, commanded by my executive officer, pass to the left of the camp, attacking towards Munich, and my right force that I was commanding, attacking to the right of the camp. I didn't want to get slowed down by any concentration camp because I didn't figure that was a military objective. I didn't see how it was going to harm me any, and my mission was to take Munich. So I jumped up the next morning in that formation, and my two units, the concentration camp was in between my two units, my right units and my left.
Who was commanding the other unit? What was his name?
Major Kessler, who was my executive officer. And then I had the right unit. And we had the tanks divided between the two forces. But we had attacking in the outskirts of Munich. Dachau is about 9 or 10 miles from Munich, the city of Dachau.
So you went to Munich before Dachau then?
No. The city of Dachau was in my zone of action, which meant that I had to clear it. There was a river there, the Amper River. I mean, the bridges that were going to be blown. So I had the right company. I told them, you clear the city of Dachau, but if you run into any opposition that you can bypass, bypass it, and I'll have the reserve company come up and take care of it. I didn't want to get slowed down. So we jumped off that morning in that configuration. Well, the Germans weren't putting up a great deal of resistance. I lost a few men. I had a few men killed and wounded that morning. Well, then somewhere around 11 o'clock that morning, I got an urgent radio message ordering me, this is almost the exact wording of the message, you are to proceed immediately to capture the concentration camp at Dachau. Upon securing that camp, you are not to allow anyone in or out. Well, I digested that, and I was quite angry, because it meant then that I had to divide up my force. I couldn't pull the two attack units out, but I had a reserve company, but I had a following. I had two companies in attack, and then a reserve company was following. So that meant then I had to deploy my reserve company to take the concentration camp, and that is, from a tactical viewpoint, is very poor practice. Now my battalion is split up, and I had no longer can, it's no longer self-supporting. It has no mutual support. Because here my reserve company is taking on another mission. Well, I was very angry about it, but I didn't have any choice. What I wanted to get on and say, well, send the reserve battalion in there, see. That's what they should have done. But there was a battalion in reserve following me. But anyway, since I was the closest to it, somebody was antsy to get it right away. Well, I then immediately got a hold of the reserve company commander, which was Company I, 157th, and explained the mission to him. And the camp was a little, maybe a mile off to the left of where I company was. And I said, I don't know why or what we're going to run into there, but I'll go with you. And I'll give you an extra platoon of machine guns. So I took a platoon of machine guns from I Company, or from M Company, which is a heavy weapons company, and attached it to I Company so they'd have extra firepower. Did not take any tanks because the tanks were already committed. I didn't think I'd need tanks anyway. And so somewhere right after noon, around 1 o'clock, we approached the camp and then could see the walls. You couldn't see anything inside because it just looked like an ordinary German military post to us on the outside. There was a masonry fence maybe 8 feet high or something like that around where we entered. And when we saw the entrance to the camp, but from the outside it looked like a regular German military post. Well, when I looked down the street and I saw the main gate, I decided I would not go in that way, because if they were going to defend it, that would be the most likely place to defend. So I had the company deploy off to the left of the gate, and at that time then we ran into a railway train, had 39 cars in it, various types of boxcars, some were old passenger cars, some were open gondola type, like coal cars or ore cars. And there was a spur line leading from Dachau, the city of Dachau, into the concentration camp. And on that train, each car was filled with human bodies. They were all dead, as far as we could determine. Anyway, we searched these about 40 cars, and all we found was dead people in there. Obviously, civilians that they had on. Some of them had on striped uniforms, they had on miscellaneous clothing. Some had enough strength to crawl out, and they fell on the ground near the railway car. And there were about 2,000 dead in there. Well, my men, there was not much said, but I could see the men were getting very angry. So then I gave the order, let's go into the camp.
Did you know who these civilians were that were dead on the...
No, we didn't have any idea where they came from or what they were doing there. All we knew is we found a railway car with... as I recall, there were 39 cars, and each was filled with dead bodies, and they were horribly emaciated. They were skin and bones, and evidently they'd been shut up in those cars, and whether they were being taken out or brought in, we did not know. We later found out that they had been brought in from Buchenwald, and probably they were on the road at least 2 weeks, because we were bombing the tracks, and they got no food or water, and they just died terrible deaths. Well, we saw immediately that they had been starved to death and been shut up, and they just all died from a lack of food and water.
Was there a smell? Was there an odor?
Yes, some of them had been dead for several days, and there was quite an odor. And some of us, just a few, had, I don't know exactly what happened, but when the Germans deserted that train, they opened some of the doors to the boxcars. I don't know why. I suppose they checked it out to see if anybody was still alive. But they had deserted. We found out that most of the SS troops had deserted Dachau about 2 to 3 days before we arrived. They knew we were coming, and they wanted to get out of there. So that was our first evidence. Then we began to have a feeling of what we were going to find inside the camp.
Were there men and women and children?
Yes, there weren't any. There were some women, dead women, in the train, in the train cars. No children. I never saw a child at any time at Dachau. There were a small number of women.
I think we'll stop the tape now and then continue the next one. Interviewee is General Felix Sparks. Interviewer Tony Katch-Binstock in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America, and the interview is being conducted in English. General Sparks, at the end of the last tape, you were telling us about the train that you encountered, and would you just continue about...
Well, the train was our first introduction to concentration camps. Actually, we were stunned. That's the best way I can put it. Now, we were hardened combat veterans at that time. We'd been in combat almost 2 years. Our unit spent more time in combat than any other unit, our division, than any other unit of the United States Army, with the exception of the 3rd Infantry Division. So we were used to death. I mean, death was a constant companion. But we had never visioned anything of this magnitude, of a couple of thousand dead civilians herded into boxcars and kept there until they died. It stunned us. We had a difficult time believing it. And not much was said. I couldn't think of a thing to say. And I'm not one for lacks in words. About there, then there began to be some cursing. I heard people talking about getting those dirty Nazi dogs, and some men got furious, and I saw a few who broke down and were crying. Well, we searched all the cars and kind of came to our senses, and that's when I gave the order then, let's go into the camp. So the main body of I Company and the company commander followed the track which went into the camp itself. And it was a big gate there, was locked with a padlock. And one of the men shot the padlock off with his rifle. And I went with the right platoon, which I found out, we went in what we call a skirmish formation. That is, the two lead platoons fan out, and lead scouts go forward from each platoon. Well, I went with the right platoon, which did not follow the track. We found ourselves faced with a masonry, high masonry wall. Well, I couldn't, it was hard to scramble over. And I left my radio and my radio operator and my Jeep at that time. I was in a Jeep, or had been. And so I left them outside the camp. So I did not have my radio when I went in. What I had was my rifleman. There was always a rifleman with me. He was sort of my bodyguard. And I had an interpreter, a German interpreter. That is, he was an American soldier, but he was born in Germany. He was a young American soldier. Migrated to Germany. His father was a professor at some college in Germany, and he did not like Hitler. So he got out while he could And I think the soldier was like 10 years old when he came to the States, because he spoke obviously fluent German.
Was he a Jew, do you know? Was he Jewish?
No, he was not Jewish. His name was Carl Mann. He was about 19 years old at the time, just out of high school. And he was with me all the time, and the rifleman. The three of us were always right together, because interpreter, you know, was invaluable to me. And the rifleman I used also to carry messages, to give orders back and forth. And we climbed over the wall following the right platoon, which would fan out on a long skirmish line, and each man went over. Now, we did not receive any fire from the Germans, which I really wasn't anticipating much of a battle there. As I had then, with a reinforced company, I had about 200 men, a little over 200 men. But the post was very large. It covered well over 100 acres, I guess several hundred acres. And when we first got into it, what we found, the left unit with the company commander, they got into warehouse areas and maintenance buildings. There were a great number of buildings in there. There were barracks, great stores of supplies. When I went over the wall, I found myself in the back of a very beautiful home, which I immediately assumed were officers' homes. And I yelled at my two men, be careful of booby traps. We did not encounter any, I might add, at any time in Dachau. But I went in the back door of this home with my two men. And I looked around, and we walked in carefully and walked through the house. It was empty. But in one bedroom, I found children's toys scattered on the floor and great signs of disarray, like hasty packing had been done, and this German family, officer family, had left. So looking at that, I knew immediately that probably many of the officers, or most of them, had fled the area. These are all SS officers. The concentration camps are strictly SS people and Gestapo. So I immediately assumed that when I saw this hasty evacuation, that the camp had been at least partially evacuated. So we walked in carefully, and I went out the front door of this home, and then I found myself in a beautifully landscaped area. It was like a small city, you know, paved roads, roses were blooming or starting to bloom, as I recall. The grass was pretty green. And it was just a very nice residential area. At that point, I heard some firing off to my left, and I recognized a small arms fire, and no automatic weapons. Then I pressed forward with my group following this platoon, and we went very slowly because searching all those buildings took a great deal of time. We were extremely cautious, but soldiers entered every building and searched it, the building. And then they started finding Germans, soldiers, hiding out mostly in those various buildings. They were hiding in there. So I further realized that there was not going to be much opposition, if
any. Were the buildings homes of officers, or were they the maintenance things you were talking about?
We didn't search the officers' homes, except the one I went through. But when we got past those, we found the barracks where the SS troops slept. And we found their headquarters building, the post headquarters, a very beautiful building. And I was following this right platoon at a safe distance behind them. I didn't want to be the lead rifleman. And I came to the headquarters building, and I went inside of it and looked around, and it was empty. And then I heard more firing on to my front. And I immediately left. And right after I left, we picked up our first prisoner that I saw. It was a man in a striped uniform. He was hiding out. He came out with his hands up, and I saw immediately that he was a prisoner. He was not a German soldier. So I told my interpreter, "Can see if you can communicate with him." He could. This guy could speak German, but it turned out he was Polish, but he could speak pretty good German. I guess he'd been a prisoner for some time. Well, I said, "You tell him to stay right with me. I want him to explain to me where we are and what's going on." So this guy stayed with us. And I moved forward very slowly. And there was sporadic firing. Not a lot, but sporadic. Whether the Germans actually did any shooting or not, I do not know. My men claimed that they were fired upon, but in my opinion, they were not. But I couldn't. Vision was difficult because of the many buildings. Everywhere I looked, there were buildings in my way. And we didn't see the prison camp itself. I didn't know where the prisoners were. I assumed that there were prisoners there somewhere because of what this guy had picked up. So I kept going forward very slowly. Then I came to a point where there was an L-shaped cement structure that had been used as a coal bin. It was open, it had no top on it, but it had a wall about 8 or 9 feet high on two sides of it, L-shaped. And I could see what was left of, there were coal dust on the ground. So I knew it had been used then as a sort of a storage place for coal. And there was a small railroad track running into that area, narrow gauge track. And I saw what, to me, I'm from a mining country, was an old mining car, ore mining car. And I immediately realized that they had used that little track to haul coal from wherever it was brought in and that dump it in that area. And the track ran right along the area. At that time when I got there, I Company had collected a number of prisoners. And I put them up in that little area. And there was probably 50 or 60 German prisoners, German soldiers. And they had two or three men guarding them. And one man was on a machine gun. One of my men had a light machine gun mounted, aimed at this, where the prisoners lined up against this wall. Well, I watched it for a couple of 3 minutes. And one of the I Company men came up to me and said, "Colonel," he said, you better see what we found." So I started to follow him off. And I had my back turned when I heard the light machine gun go off. I was probably 40, 50 feet away at that time. I wheeled around and the machine gunner let loose a burst of probably 20 rounds. We always fired machine guns in bursts to keep from burning the gun up. And he fired a continuous burst of probably about 20 rounds and stopped. Well, at that time, I was running towards him, and he had his back towards me. And I kicked him in the back with my boot and grabbed him by the collar. He was a small man. And I yanked him backwards, and I said, "What the hell are you doing?" He started crying, and he said, "Well, Colonel, they were trying to get away." Well, they were milling around. But they weren't trying to, in my opinion, they weren't trying to get away. Well, I looked over the scene, and the Germans dived on the ground to the ground when he opened up. When I turned around, they were hitting the ground. And I couldn't tell just exactly how many he had killed or shot. Anyway, I yanked him off the gun, and I yelled to another man, "You well, there was a sergeant there. I said, "Sergeant, put somebody else in this gun." At the same time, when I ran over there, I drew my pistol, my 45, and fired it into the air several times to get everybody's attention. And I was yelling, "There'll be no more firing unless I give a specific order." Well, the damage was done. There was a small hospital unit right behind this wall. It had, I could see the Red Cross on the top of the building. So we checked out the men that had been shot. There were about 11 that were dead. Some others were wounded. And we took them into that hospital. And there was a German doctor there and a German medical crew. Well, then I ordered the company commander to move all of the prisoners out of the post as rapidly as possible. So they rounded up then what was left of them. There was 11 dead, and 7 or 8 that were wounded. But the rest of them were all right. They got up, and we marched them off.
These were all Germans. These were all Germans?
These are German soldiers. Then I got that thing halfway under control, what I thought was more or less under control. I heard some firing then ahead of me. Well, I couldn't see where it was, but I went then pretty rapidly. I didn't waste any time. And I came out, then for the first time I saw the prison area. Up to that time, it had been obscured by the buildings. I could not see it. It was in a far extreme corner of the whole post, occupied only a small portion of the entire garrison area. It was just a small, well, a confinement area. Maybe it was a mile all the way around, or circumference around the thing. But it was a fairly substantial area, and I could see, when I first got to where I could see it, I was right next to a place that I found was a crematorium. And I looked in there, and they had bodies stacked in a small cement room next to the crematorium. These were nude bodies, and they were stacked like cordwood in that building, in that little small building. And next to it was the crematorium that had four coal-fired furnaces. The furnaces were not operating when we got there, and I don't think had been operating for several days because they were cold. I surveyed that for a minute or two, and then I went out to follow the path along the wall of the, I saw the confinement area was a high barbed wire fence surrounding the area. And it was a guard tower about every 200 yards. And there was a huge cement guard towers with a machine gun and a small German crew in each guard tower. Well, I came across the first guard tower, and there were 5 German soldiers lying near the base of the tower, which I immediately assumed had been the crew that was in that guard tower. Well, I assumed that my men had killed them. Then I walked on down. One of the I Company men said, "Colonel, the entrance to this is right down here." Well, it was about 100 yards from the guard tower, and I followed along. There was just immediately outside of the cement, the barbed wire fence, was a path, maybe 4 feet wide, that led to all the guard towers. And outside of the path was a moat. I call it a moat because it was had been constructed and it held water. And the water came from the Amper River, which ran through the city of Dachau. And it was filled with water. It was on the outside of the path. Well, I followed along the edge of that moat. And it was a line of trees all the way along that moat. And I got down then to, when I saw the entrance to the prison area. And there was a building, or several buildings, right at the entrance. There was one building that bridged the entrance, and I immediately assumed that was what we in American parlance would call a guardhouse. It's where the guards slept when they're on shift. The Germans call it the Jurhaus, I found out later. Well, I was standing there, all of a sudden, at that time, the first thing I saw was several hundred bodies lying inside in an open space near this gate to the prison area. And there were several hundred dead people lying there. Most had been stripped, nude, no clothing on them. And I didn't see any live people in there at that moment. But just a few moments later, the whole place erupted. And the prisoners started streaming out of the barracks. I could see a large number of barracks, small one-story barracks inside the prison compound that housed the prisoners. Well, they came streaming out. They had finally realized what was going on. And they screamed and they shouted. And they started tossing bodies through the air. And I was just stunned. For a moment, I couldn't figure out what was going on. Because there were thousands of prisoners. It turned out there was about almost 32,000 in there. And the ones that were still able to walk around were tossing these bodies over their outstretched hands, and they were tearing at them with their hands. And I immediately said to my interpreter, ask this guy, this prisoner was with us, what's going on in there? They talked in German for a few seconds, and my interpreter said, well, Colonel, he said they're killing the informers. That's the word he used to me. Well, we were helpless to do anything about it, but it quieted down, and I said to start yelling at them in German and tell them that they have to remain here, and we'll get food and medicine up to them as rapidly as we can, but they're not to try to get out of the compound. I could see, I didn't want to have prisoners running all over the area. We were still in combat. Besides, most of them were desperately ill. So it quieted down, and I was yelling the company then. We started encircling the whole area and taking over the guard towers. And it got very quiet there for a few minutes. And the prisoners were just inside the compound, were just standing there, and very listlessly. And I was yelling, don't throw them any food. I figured they'd fight over it. Well, it quieted down for a moment, and all of a sudden, I'm standing near the entrance to the prison area. There was a small cement bridge that went over the moat, and then there was a gate, a double gate that opened into the prison compound. It was closed, but it was not locked. So I'm standing there surveying the scene. And suddenly, three jeeps come up to the bridge. And there was a General Linden from the 42nd Division was in the lead jeep. And he said, Colonel, I have a lady reporter here. She wants to interview these prisoners. Well, I said, she can't go in there. I said, we're not going to open that gate because the people were pressed up against the gate. They want out. She can't go in there. And I said, my orders are not to let anyone in or out, and that's what I'm doing. Well, he said, I'll take the responsibility for it. I said, well, General, you're not in your area. You're out of your combat zone. This is my area. And I take my orders from my commanding general. Well, he said, I see no harm in it. And while I'm talking to him, this woman gets out of the jeep, the second jeep, and runs up to the gate and opens it. Well, pandemonium broke loose there. The prisoners surged forward. Then I ordered my men to start firing over their heads and rush that gate and close it. They did. They started firing their rifles into the air, and about a half a dozen of them rushed up to the gate and got it closed. The woman got frightened in the meantime, and she ran back. Well, before she went in there, she said to me, she said, Colonel, I want to interview some important prisoners. She said, Cardinal Niemöller, she said. Well, I never heard of Cardinal Niemöller. And the Prince of Luxembourg, and she gave one other name that I didn't catch. Well, I said, I don't know anything about them, but you can't go in there. And while I'm talking to the general, she did anyway. Well, she ran back after the firing started and got in a jeep. And then the general and I got into a pretty heated argument. He said, I'm relieving you of command and I'm taking responsibility. I said, no, this is my area. You're not relieving me of command. So finally I said to one of the privates standing there, I said, Private, escort this general and his party out of here. They had come in the main gate to the whole area, which was on two blocks from this prison gate. And well, the private stepped forward. He didn't know what the hell to do. This general carried a little stick, I don't know, swagger stick or riding crop, about that long with him. And he was a rather short guy, a little pudgy. And as the private approached the jeep, he whacked him over the helmet with his stick. Well, it had already been a long, trying day. I exploded at that point. I hauled out my .45 and said, you son of a bitch, if you touch another one of my men, I'll kill you right here. He was standing up in the front of his jeep when he hit the soldier. He sat down. And in the third jeep, which I hadn't paid much attention to, there was two lieutenant colonels on it. One was the commanding officer of the 222nd Infantry Battalion of the 42nd Infantry Division. The other one was the battalion commander. This battalion commander, named Felix, he came running up to me and said, you can't talk to my general like that. He said, I'll see you after the war. I said, well, you son of a bitch, what's wrong with right now? Well, he went back and got in his jeep and the party left. But as he left, the general said, I'll see you before a general court-martial. Well, that was the last thing that wasn't worrying me at that point. They left anyway. And then things got fairly normal.
Who was the reporter? What was her name?
Her name was Marguerite Higgins. She represented a newspaper in New York. Maggie Higgins, they called her. A very attractive young lady. She had on like army fatigues. Anyway, they left. And a short time later, our commanding general arrived, General Frederick. And I told him what happened. He said, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. And then at that time, I had halted my other companies in the attack. So we got things quieted down, and I got word that they were sent up some army hospitals as rapidly as they could. And I got word then from my regimental commander that one of the companies from the reserve battalion, which was our first battalion at that time, would be up to relieve my company so that I could pull my company out and reassemble the battalion to resume the attack into Munich the next morning. This general came in somewhere around 3:30 in his party that evening. So I got word that C Company would be up to relieve me. And shortly thereafter, C Company arrived. Well, I had men scattered all over that area. And so we were trying to extricate my men, and the C Company commander came up, and he established his headquarters in that hospital, a little hospital, and took over the guarding. That's all we were doing was guarding. What we were doing was keeping the prisoners in. That was our mission, to not let them get out and run all over the countryside until somebody relieved us.
I think we'll end this tape again and continue on the next one. In 1996, the interviewee is General Felix Sparks, interviewer Tony Catch Binstock. The interview is being conducted in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America, and is being done in English. General, when we ended the tape, you were saying that Company C, I believe, had come in.
In the meantime, our regimental commander, Colonel O'Brien, had come up, and as well as General Frederick. It was a division commander. He was a major general. Colonel O'Brien was a full colonel. I was a lieutenant colonel. And we were taking inventory, and my company commander actually went inside of the stockade part. And there were some large buildings right inside the gate that was used as that's where they prepared the food for the inmates, what little they got, which was very little. And practically all of them were terribly emaciated. And they had two barracks in there that were filled with sort of an infirmary, two infirmaries, and almost all the people in there were dying, or some were already dead. And some of them had been dead for several days, the ones lying out, so the smell of death was just overpowering. We were still having a difficult time trying to comprehend. We just couldn't, it was hard to realize how those people had been treated. And we were still partly dazed, I'll say, at the enormity of death there and the cruelty that went on there. But it did quieten down, and C Company came up and took over the guarding of the prisoners. I then stayed there until about right at dark and saw that everything was fairly secure. In the meantime, my battalion headquarters had moved up to the city of Dachau and established a headquarters there in a building in the city. And one of the men from the headquarters came up and took me back to the headquarters. I didn't know where it was. And I just had gotten there when I got word that I was to relieve C Company because the 1st Battalion would resume the attack in the morning. My battalion would not. Well, I was a little unhappy about that. But I didn't relieve C Company until we started that night and in the early morning. And by early morning, I didn't put I Company back in. I took one of my other companies, L Company, and put it in the camp. And then I departed with what was left of the battalion. Short time after that, I got word that the 1st Battalion had run across another concentration camp. which it turned out was one of these slave labor camps, had about 8,000 people in it, and they were in much better shape than the ones in Dhaka, just a few miles from Dhaka. I was ordered to relieve the 1st Battalion so that they could continue the attack. So I sent my K Company over to relieve the 1st Battalion at that concentration camp. That's on the 30th of April. The morning we took, the day we took the went, first went into the camp was April 29th, which was Sunday. The following morning, then, I had resumed control of the camp with my L Company. I sent my K Company over to the nuke camp that the 1st Battalion had liberated. And then I took what was left of the battalion, which was one company, I Company and M Company, the heavy weapons company, and my headquarters into Munich. And we established a command post because the 1st Battalion went right into Munich with very little difficulty on the morning of the 30th. The Germans were shot at that point. They just weren't putting up any more resistance. So I followed the 1st Battalion in and set up a headquarters in the city of Munich. That morning of the 30th, I got word that an artillery battalion from the Corps Army would come up to relieve me that morning of the 30th. Well, I had L Company in there, so I pulled L Company out. I took L Company in with me, and this artillery battalion commander came up, and I explained the situation to him. He took over the camp. Well, I got into Munich, and late that evening, I got word that I had to go back and relieve that artillery battalion. By that time, I'm furious. Well, I said, I'm not going to be in any hurry about it. So the next morning, that would have been on May 1st, I guess, I sent L Company back there. I went back with them, and we took over the camp again, and were there until May 3rd. When L Company was there until May 3rd, when a unit from our division, 179th Infantry, took over the camp. Well, that was about it as far as the camp was concerned.
Let me ask a couple questions about what you observed in the camp. Did you speak with any of the inmates or the prisoners yourself personally through the interpreter?
Yes. The ones I spoke to, it finally dawned on me after we'd been there a little while that we encountered several prisoners who were outside of the prison compound, and they were in pretty good shape. And then it dawned on me these guys were what we might call trustees. They did all the dirty work. And talking to the prisoner who was with me, he explained to me that they did all the dirty work. They're the ones that had to handle the bodies, put them in the crematorium. And they got better food than the ones inside. I don't know how many there were, but there were probably a dozen or more. I saw four or five. They were outside, and they were all in pretty good physical shape, as contrasted to the ones who were inside, who hardly anybody weighed more than 90 pounds, let's say, just skin and bones. Well, this one guy, this prisoner I had, and took me around and showed me some aspects of the camp. He showed me an area where there was some boards, like lattice work, over some sand. And he got down and explained to me how the Germans executed many German officers, he said, sometime before we arrived. They made them get down and put their heads down, and they put a bullet in the back of their head.
But apparently, Germans were killing Germans?
Well, apparently that was a residue of the attack on Hitler. See, they didn't know who to hold responsible for that attack on Hitler, so they just picked out a bunch of people who were on the staff of the general who was one of the plotters. Some of them came to Dachau, and they were executed there. Or anybody that they thought was wanted to give up at the last minute were executed. These were German officers. They were the only ones that so the prison told me, that were executed in that manner. There were a number of prisoners hung or executed in Dachau, but they were executed by hanging. Now, just inside the compound was a small, next to the kitchen area, there was a small compound that was a prison area within the prison. Anybody that violated the rules were picked up, or if they tried to escape, they were put in this small room in, just inside the prison area, and there they were beaten and tortured, and then generally were hung. There was a place there with a small spike coming out of the cement wall, L-shaped, and there they would put the prisoners on a chair with a rope around their neck, and then they'd yank the chair out under them, and that's how they were hung. We also found some pictures where they had hung them up by their hands to a pole or a tree. Exquisite torture. The Germans took too many pictures. They liked to photograph all the horrors that they engaged in. Anyway, I got a pretty good bird's eye view from the trustees, that I call trustees, that told me what had been going on in there. I never went inside the compound. My company commander did. He went in and took an inventory of the kitchen to see if there was any food there. He and some of his men and trying to figure out how we were going to try to give them some food. But I myself never went inside the compound.
You did go into the, so you did see the crematorium?
Crematorium was out right outside of the compound.
And the gas chamber?
There was a gas chamber there, and there was a shower, browser bad or something like that they call it, browser bad, had a sign on it, which means shower. Then there was another small cement structure there. It was clearly marked gas. I mean, it had the skull and crossbones sort of like on it. We immediately knew it was a gas chamber. However, as far as any evidence about that gas chamber ever being used, there's not the slightest evidence that it was ever used to kill anyone. And it quite clearly was not, from what all the prisoners said, and there were subsequent investigations indicated that that gas chamber was used only to fumigate clothing. It was never used to exterminate people, and I'm convinced that that was a fact. There was a gas chamber some miles out of Munich, but that was used. I think some old castle, they call it. I don't recall the name, but we found out that prisoners had been transported to there to be executed. But Dachau was not an extermination camp per se, not like Auschwitz or Buchenwald, where they executed thousands. The executions in Dachau probably numbered no more than 1,000 or 2. Most of the people who died there died of disease. When we practically all the inmates in there had acute dysentery, and many of them had typhus. So, and they were just in, they were, well, to give you an example, the barracks that were in there were constructed to hold about somewhere around 250 inmates. And boy, that was crowding it. We got there, there was something like 1,500 crowded into those small structures. So there were no, sanitation was non-existent. And their resistance to any kind of disease like pneumonia, flu, whatever, it just did not exist. So they died primarily, I would say, of severe malnutrition. Now one of them, I did talk to the prisoners and say, what did you get to eat? Well, they said, we got a cup of coffee in the morning and a piece of bread in the evening. This was at the last. Apparently, years before, they had treated them much better. But in the last year of the war, Germany itself was running out of food. So they were getting almost nothing to eat at all, and the malnutrition was extreme. I say hardly anyone weighed over 95 pounds. And, of course, the resistance went down, and typhus was endemic. And even after a couple of days, we had two Army hospitals. Before I left, before my battalion left, two Army hospitals came up, and they immediately started taking care of the prisoners. We did not have any responsibility except as guards. So they immediately took over the care of the prisoners, and they died at the rate of 50 to 75 a day for the first week or so after those two hospitals got there. They were just too far gone. They could do nothing for them. So they kept dying like 50, 75, 100 a day for about the first week until, with food and medicine, most of them eventually recovered. So the situation in there, the conditions were just beyond belief. No sanitation, utter cruelty. They had what they call a roll call square. That's where all the dead bodies were that we saw inside the camp when we first came up. And that's where they assembled the prisoners. If anybody tried to violate the rules or anything, everybody in the camp had to turn out. For 24 hours, they had to stand in that roll call square. And it's pretty cold in Munich, in that area. The temperature and the weather is much comparable to Denver here. Snows in the wintertime, and it gets quite cold. And they had nothing but thin clothing on. Of course, in the process, many passed out, many died at what they call the roll call square. But that said, they would punish everybody in the camp if somebody broke the rules. And to get back to these bodies that I saw being tossed through the air, we discovered that they called them capos, C-A-P-O. I don't know where the name comes from. Anyway, they call those capos. And in each barracks, there was a German who was in charge of the barracks. Now, he was a German prisoner. You have to remember that Dachau was originally constructed to house Germans only. That was the first concentration camp that Hitler had constructed right after he took power in 1933. Well, that was to house German dissidents. And that they threw Catholic priests particularly were their favorite target, and professors and people that they thought were enemies of the Nazi movement. So that's what Dachau was for originally. In the last year or so of the war, they started throwing some ordinary criminals in there. Plus, there was quite a resistance movement, or a small resistance movement, in Bavaria. And many of those people were apprehended and they were put in Dachau. And they were there when we got there. But each barracks there was a German who was in charge of it. He was the capo. And he's the one that reported any infractions of the rules. And then he reported somebody, then they were tortured and very often executed. So that's the reason the prisoners hated them. They killed them all with their bare hands. And I suspect with boards and whatever. And then we found the evidence of gruesome medical experiments with Dr. Schilling and one other doctor performed experiments on Rasher, was a Dr. Rasher, performed gruesome medical experiments on the people. Usually all the experiments ended up in rather agonizing death. And they had pictures of them.
Did you see those?
Yes.
What became of those pictures?
Well, they were used in the war crimes trial. Germans were great picture takers. And I remember they had pictures of one prisoner they had in some kind of pressure chamber, and they would simulate different altitudes. This is for the Luftwaffe, for the German Air Force, apparently, to see how, at what altitude they would die. And I had them in these pressure chambers, and it showed a man gradually dying as they reduced the pressure. The human body literally explodes, and you get to zero, down to zero pressure. And then the other experiment he was conducting for the Luftwaffe was to see how people could, how long they could exist in cold water. So they'd start out at degrees like 40 degrees and strip them naked and then get down to 30 degrees and see how long they lasted at various temperatures. Presumably this was for the German Air Force in case they ditched out over the sea. So those were agonizing deaths, of course. There were those two doctors who performed, I think, practically all of the experiments there. There were all kinds of pictures of brutality, at, like people hanging up to a tree by their hands. Some of them took great delight, some of the German SS troops took great delight in that torture. Well, shortly after, a day or so after we had taken the camp, this General Linden started throwing his weight around. And the our commanding general came down to my headquarters one morning. It was about a day or two days, I think, after we had taken the camp. He said, "Well, things are heating up here for you." He said, "General Linden is causing a big stink." And they're pointing the IG of 7th Army to make an investigation. He said, "I'm going to send you on home." He said, "Our division has been selected to participate in the invasion of Japan. And we're going back to the States, and we're going to retrain and re-equip, and then we'll be part of the invasion forces for Japan. And you can go home and take a leave, get a leave, and we'll be going back to the States right away. And you can rejoin us in the States." So I was a little unhappy about that, but he said, "I'll send a command car down for you like tomorrow morning, and you can take that command car and take whatever people you want and report to Le Havre, France," which is a port. I was to be assigned to the Assembly Area Command, which operated the ports, which is an American Army organization. They call it the Assembly Area Command. The purpose was to get troops back to the States. That was a reason for that headquarters. So the next morning I left, taking several of my men. And it took us, the roads were in terrible shape and clogged up, and it took us 2 or 3 days to make it to Le Havre, which was 500-600 miles away. And I reported in there one morning. We'd spent the night in Paris, and went to Le Havre the next morning, got there before noon. And I checked in with the transportation office at Le Havre. The sergeant had a little office at the end of the dock there, and said, "I'm Colonel Sparks, and I think I have orders here to be sent back to the States." And he looked me over and he said, "Well, Colonel, I'll have to call my lieutenant." So he got on the phone there, and 2 or 3 minutes, there came a lieutenant, first lieutenant, MP, military police officer. He said, "Colonel, I'm sorry, but I've got orders to take you back to 7th Army headquarters." Well, I was in no mood to be taken anywhere. So I said, "Well, look around you, lieutenant." My men raised their rifles. I said, "I'll go back to 7th Army headquarters, but you're not going to take me. Will you give me your word?" He said. I said, "Yes, I'll give you my word." So we left and went back to Paris and got a little drunk that night, I think. And, I think we spent a couple of days in Paris. And then I took off for back to where I came from. I found 7th Army headquarters was near Augsburg, which is in Bavaria. It was in a small town near Augsburg. When I got there, I reported in, I was told that the 7th Army headquarters was being disbanded, and the 3rd Army was taking over. The 7th Army was going to be reconstituted in Austria, going to be occupation troops in Austria. And then I would report to General Patton, 3rd Army headquarters in Augsburg. Augsburg is quite a large city, not far from Munich. So I found the 7th Army headquarters that evening in a very large building, looked like a municipal building, and reported in. And I said, well, General Patton's not here. Come back in the morning. So I found quarters for me and my men that night, and the next morning, about 9 o'clock, I went back. And I was told by the chief of staff that General Patton was out, would not be back till sometime after lunch. Said, you go have lunch. You come back at 1 o'clock. Well, I came back at 1 o'clock and waited a little while, and somebody came out and said, okay, General Patton, we'll see you now. So I went into one of the room, a room that he had, a small room, and a couple of chairs and a desk, and I saluted. And he said, well, sit down, Colonel. And he said, well, he said to Colonel, he said, I have some very serious charges against you and some of your men. Well, I said, General, I'd like a chance to explain. I don't know what the charges are, but I'd like to have a chance to explain. He said, didn't you serve under me in Africa and Sicily? And I said, yes, I did, General. He said, well, you've been a damn fine soldier. He said, I don't need any explanation. He said, you go on back to your unit. The whole interview lasted no more than a minute or 2 minutes, maybe. So I saluted and left and went back to my unit. Then I found out the Inspector General, in the meantime, was conducting a very thorough investigation. But a strange thing, nobody, when the report came out that I found just a few years ago, it said that I was not available. That's not true. I was not there the first few days, but I came back and was back a good 10 days, was available all the time, but nobody ever said hello or goodbye to me. And after I'd been back about 10 days, and I got orders then to report to Reims, to Shoah headquarters. And that's what I did. And then from there, I came on back to the States, got back in August of 1945. So I was always curious as to what happened in that investigation. And I was told from various sources that investigator Patton had stopped the investigation and ordered the whole thing dismissed. Well, I didn't know. But as the years went on, none of us who were DACA ever talked much about it until I started this Holocaust Memorial Week, various states did. And then I began to hear of claims by the 42nd Infantry Division that they were the first in DACA and the ones who were liberated. Well, that surprised me considerably. I knew that they had been there. And at that time, then I started my own investigation of trying to find out what happened. There were many things that happened in DACA, obviously, that I did not know about, because in a large area like that with all the buildings, my vision was always limited. So I knew that things had gone on there that I did not know about, but I wasn't sure what. But I finally had a good friend who was an inspector general in the Army, was a colonel, had retired, and a few years ago I asked him to see if he could dig out all the records that are available. And he knew his way around in Washington, and anybody trying to find anything in the United States archives with hundreds of millions of documents, it's a daunting task. He started it anyway and spent several days at that job. And he discovered then and prepared for me the most complete record of DACA that has ever been compiled. This huge book that he got records from archives. And there, finally, was a long missing investigation.
Well, let's continue this on the next tape then, General. September 17th, 1996. The interviewee is General Felix Sparks. Interviewer is Tony Catch Binstock in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America. And the interview is being conducted in English. General Sparks, you were just at the end of the last tape telling us about this, that you had had a friend compile this for you. Finish explaining about
that. Yes, this retired Inspector General from the Army, who's been a longtime friend, spent a lot of time, days and days, trying to research all the records pertaining to Dachau, and he did. This is probably the most complete document in existence relating to all the peripheral things, the days before, the days after, what happened. These include Army orders, Corps orders, 42nd Division orders, 45th Division orders, all in battalion journals, everything that could possibly relate to Dachau he dug up. But the important thing that he dug up was the Inspector General's report of the investigation and the subsequent action by the Commanding General of the 7th United States Army and the 3rd United States Army. Well, this came as an eye-opener to me because the reason it couldn't be found, most of the documents had been classified as secret and were not available until declassification took place of slowly over the years. The various documents have been declassified. So it was after the declassification that took place that this colonel was able to find all of these records. And he has in here the complete report of all the testimony of all the witnesses in the case, which is over 100 pages long. There's several hundred pages in this thing which he sent me. But he has a complete report, the action of the higher headquarters. And as I say, it came as an eye-opener to me because I was never informed of any charges against anybody, except General Patton said there were some serious charges, but he didn't say what. What I found out from the Inspector General's report was that he had recommended that several people be tried for the murder of prisoners. Some of my men, and much to my surprise, also some men from the 42nd Division, which puzzled me. But after I got to reading all the testimony and all the pertinent documents, then long unanswered questions came to light. Actually, the 42nd Division was involved more than I thought originally. What happened was that we had been in there about an hour or so, and according to the testimony of General Linden, the principal witness, he said that he came driving up to the camp.
Dachau.
And he heard some firing inside of the compound. He then ordered a couple of his officers to go in and see what was happening. Well, of course, that was my men in there. There was sporadic firing going on the whole time. In addition to killing some German guards, the men also dispatched a number of large, rather vicious guard dogs that were in there. I've never heard that mentioned before by the 42nd or anybody else. But
who were the whose guard dogs were these?
They used them to patrol the exterior of the prison compound.
Were they German?
Yeah.
The German dog. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
They were a miscellaneous assortment of dogs. Most of them I saw were Dobermans. But my men shot them. Anyway, I discovered that what, as I came as a surprise to me, that prior to my run-in with General Linden and his small party, the 42nd had been in there before that. What happened, another surprise to me, came that nobody ever mentioned the presence of this Marguerite Higgins. Nobody ever mentioned her presence. In all the testimony, the 42nd never mentioned her presence. Although they made one slip-up that I found. In their division journal, I found that she had reported to their headquarters that morning. That's the only reference to her. And that was, I say, a slip-up, I think, on their part. But I didn't recall recording that, but it's in here. Anyway, they never mentioned, any of the men from the 42nd Division never mentioned that she was with General Lyndon, and he never mentioned it at all. She mentioned it, of course, in her press dispatches, and it's been recorded as a book I have here, Witness to War, in which she states that she was in there with the 42nd. What I discovered was that the General Lyndon came up there with a small party, maybe 12, 14 men, something like that, mostly officers, and but Jeep drivers and a few other enlisted, and I think an interpreter. And he sent a couple of his officers. They went in, and they didn't see anything because my men were quite a distance away, but they heard the firing, and they came back and said, well, we don't see anything. Well, they came in the main gate to the whole area, which is only two blocks from the prison compound. So they, there was, according to General Lyndon, there was a couple of people who met him at the gate. He said one was a Red Cross representative. I've never figured that out. I don't think the Germans allowed any Red Cross people in the concentration camps, but I suspect it was a Gestapo man who put on a Red Cross band and said he was Red Cross, because I'm certain the Germans did not allow the Red Cross into those concentration camps. In any event, there was another officer there, and they said that they surrendered. They told General Lyndon. So at that point, this party drove on in and right up to the gate of the confinement area, which my men had not yet reached. So they drove up there, and the German guards surrendered to them at the, maybe 12 or 15, were at that Jorhaus, the entrance to the camp. And they came out with their hands up. The guards in the tower, about 100 yards away, the five of them, came down and surrendered also. And at that point, they killed them. That was the five bodies that I saw, which over the years that I thought my men had killed. Well, at that point, the 42nd group panicked, in my opinion, because they saw my men coming along the edge of the path there of the prison area. One platoon was coming along there, and they panicked because my men witnessed the killing of those five guards, which I assumed my men had done all these years. And they immediately took off and went out to the main gate, which was only two blocks away, and they had prisoners with them, probably 12, 15. And I stayed there then for a little while. And I didn't even know they had been there. And when I came along, there was no 42nd Division people there, just a Lieutenant Strickland, that was one of my platoon leaders. And that's when the prisoners erupted and the subsequent events. So I would say it's about 15 minutes later that General Lyndon came back then with the three Jeeps and had Marguerite Higgins in the second Jeep. She describes it, although in her words, she was the first one in there. In her book, Witness to War, which is a biography of her, she writes that a German SS general met her at the main gate and sent a lieutenant to escort her through the camp. Hell, there wasn't an SS general in 100 miles of Dachau. The commandant was a colonel, but he'd long since gone before we ever got there. But that was her story anyway. But she admits, she said that she had some words with an officer from the 45th Division, which was me. And she claims that I grabbed her by the shoulder. Well, I didn't touch the woman. I did order her out, but I never laid a hand on her. That's her story anyway. But the strange part of it is, it was never mentioned. In the lengthy investigation, the 42nd, never mentioned her presence. And but they were there, and they took some prisoners. But they were not the first there, and they were not the ones who liberated the camp. That's what they claim now.
But this now is record that...
This record, they admit they weren't there till 3:30 that afternoon in their sworn testimony. And they admit Well, they don't. Nobody admits killing those guards. They just one sergeant said, "Well, they're all standing there, and somebody starts shooting them." And they did. They killed all of them. And that, at that point, they decided they better get out of there because my men were right on the scene. My men saw the shooting.
Did you ever talk to your men about
that? No, I didn't know about it. I never had an opportunity, you see, because I was gone a couple of days later. And a lot of my men are still alive. We're there. They know what happened. But I've never been able to find Lieutenant Strickland. But the company commander, Lieutenant Walsh, is very much alive. He lives in Pennsylvania. He was a commander who was there and saw the whole thing, along with a large number of his men and some of my men as well. But the strange thing about the investigation, some of the witnesses testified that I was the one who stopped the shooting of the machine gun. So no charges were filed against me, apparently for that reason. But about four or five of my men were charged, five, I think, and about three or four from the 42nd Division that participated in the killing of those five guards were charged with murder, which is a very serious offense, of course, a general court-martial. Well, it was, I say, illuminating to me because now I could have been able to put together all of the pieces and know exactly what happened. The 42nd Division says, I make up all these things. I made up all this stuff. Well, I was there. I didn't make up anything. I didn't have to make up anything. So that's the way it is today, but they're still claiming that, and they're writing nasty letters to the Department of History and so on. And I don't give a damn myself who liberated it. I'm sorry that I was ever there. The only comfort we got out of that whole incident was that we were able to free several thousand poor souls who would have were dying daily before our arrival. So that many of them, at least, were able to resume somewhat of a halfway normal life. I have met several of them who are there. Some live here in Denver. I have spoken around the country on this subject, and I've met quite a few. So that was the only comfort we got out of the whole thing. And who was there first or second makes no difference to me. I just don't like them attacking me personally or my company commander or me by people who weren't there. All these people doing the attacks are people who were not there.
What are these survivors that you have met? Who do they say?
Well, they don't know. They were in such shape. They were in such bad shape. We didn't go around saying we're from this company or this division, you see. They were in such bad shape that they just know that American troops were there. Say there was no way that we could identify. Well, we didn't try to identify ourselves. No point in it. It was such pandemonium and such a strain there that we never even thought about any long-term aftermath about who was there first or who was there second. Really doesn't make any difference. The 42nd had some men there. They had about 12, 14. And they got to the prison compound before we did. But we'd been there over an hour before they got there, probably more like 2 hours before they got there. So, and it really didn't have anything to do with the liberation as such, because I have the one that had the troops there. They did not. Their 12, 14 men did nothing except to kill those. They took some prisoners and they killed those five. Well, the subsequent investigation turned out there were something like 30, 34 dead German soldiers. Books have been written that we killed 500 and something. Actually, it was probably not more than 250 in the total camp when we got there because most of them had already left. And they just left the low-ranking enlisted men, and I saw a couple of lieutenants, the comp commandant, and all the high-ranking officers, SS people, had fled there before we arrived. So it's really immaterial at this point. I just don't like the nasty letters. And I got some anonymous letters and telling me I'm a liar. I got a whole stack of stuff that General Lyndon's son has written to me, calling me a liar, that I made up all this thing. Well, it gets my dander up a little bit. I'll go before any forum in the world with any number of people to explain what happened. And from some forum wants to decide, I've got a lot of men still alive who were there. They're not all liars. And they're, you know, people who have done pretty well in life. The C Company commander is still alive, went in to relieve me. The L Company commander is dead. But some of the enlisted men are, my interpreter, still very much alive.
And they never, the government never called those people or you as witness to all of this?
They called them, yeah.
They did call
my
them.
My men were with some of my party, my interpreter and my runner were witnesses in the investigation, but they never called me. Said I was not available. I wasn't for about a week, but I came back, but I was only there about 10 days. But they knew damn well I was back. Nobody wanted to question me. That's the problem. I was a key witness in that thing. Nobody wanted to hear my story because I was bucking a general who was a West Point graduate, I might add. I'm not a West Point graduate. One peculiar thing also that happened, there was another, the two officers in the Jeep were following General Lennon, were both West Point officers. Colonel Bolduc, who was the regimental commander, and Colonel Falence, who was the battalion commander. Now, Falence testified at great length, but Colonel Bolduc was never called as a witness either. And he was there all the time. He became the chief of staff of the 42nd Division. And he was never questioned, and he was one of the key witnesses. My guess is that Colonel Bolduc wouldn't back up what the others had said. I think he was an honorable man and would not back up the stories told by Falence and Lyndon. Lyndon, in fact, says he never saw, there was some shooting, but he never saw those German soldiers being killed. The hell he didn't. He was right there on the spot. And Falence is right there on the spot. And Falence said, yeah, he shot at him, but his gun jammed. But in his previous story, he made a great mistake. He wrote a long account of that right after that, in which he said he and his men charged this guard tower with blazing rifles and killed everybody in there. That's on the record. That's in the investigation also. But that, when he came to testify on oath, he changed his story completely. Said, well, yeah, but his gun jammed. And he said he was carrying a 45 submachine caliber submachine gun. What the hell a battalion commander's doing carrying a 45 subcaliber machine gun, I do not know. It's not the normal armament for field grade officers is a 45 caliber pistol. But he admits that he was carrying a 45 Tommy gun, what we call a Tommy gun, but that it jammed. And he didn't fire, like he said in his first article. He was trying to make himself out a great hero to his, I guess, his division commander, and he wrote this long narrative before the investigation. And he got caught on it when it came along for the sworn testimony. But none of them mentioned that Marguerite Higgins was there. And that was the only reason, in my opinion, that they were there. They brought her from the division headquarters. The division record shows that she reported in the division headquarters. Doesn't say what happened after that. But I'm certain that the only reason that Lyndon and that small party came there was to permit her to interview the prisoners. But not a word about that. It didn't look good for a commanding general to go out, or assistant division commander, to go out of his area with a nice-looking young babe in somebody else's territory so that she could conduct interviews. But that's the sole reason they were there. There was no other reason for him to be there whatsoever. Wasn't in his combat zone at all. And Corps backed that up. Corps said, there's a message in there from Corps, says that is 45th Division area. That's in the record. When our commanding general complained about 42nd Division being put in there, the message from Corps came back, said that is your responsibility. That's in your zone of action, not the 42nd Division. That's on record. And it's in that book.
What are you going to do with this book, General?
The Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. heard about the record that I have They want me to mail this to them, and they will copy every bit of it and return it to me. And then I'm going to donate it to the 45th Infantry Division Museum, which is a beautiful museum in Oklahoma City about the 45th Infantry Division. Probably the finest division museum in the United States is the one maintained by the 45th Infantry Division in Oklahoma City. The state government of Oklahoma strongly supports that museum, and it has a full-time staff and tremendous exhibits. I'm going to give that book to them.
Do you still get together with some of your wartime buddies from World War II?
Yes, every year. We'll be meeting 1st of October in Orlando, Florida, and some of the principals at Dachau will be there. The company commander, Lieutenant Walsh, I Company, Lieutenant Edmonds, the C Company commander, oh, and a number of other people, enlisted people, who were present at the time also.
Maybe they'll want to give their testimony.
Well, we could all give some, all right. My runner, my rifleman is dead now, Carl Johnson, but my interpreter is still alive. My executive officer, Major Kessler, has died. Not many people left, but there are probably 25 or 30 soldiers that are still alive who were in there on the first day, at least 25 or 30. Some of them I have, well, probably more, but a lot of it's difficult to locate people after passage of 50 years. I've never been able to find Lieutenant Strickland, although we've searched records and searched. But we're all now getting up close to 80 or in our 80s, so there are not too many World War II veterans left. If you served in World War II, you got to be at least 75 today.
Well, let's go on with your career. After you came home in August of 45, then what happened?
Well, I had just been back to the States a few days when suddenly the war with Japan was over. The atomic bomb had been dropped, and shortly after that, Japan surrendered, which was around the 1st or 2nd of December in 1945.
September,
right around the 1st of September in 45. I had just been back to the States 3 or 4 days when that happened. And the 45th Division was almost immediately, most of the National Guard and Reserve Division, well, all of the National Guard and Reserve Divisions were then demobilized. They were removed from federal service. They were shipped back to the States, and everybody that wanted a discharge was discharged, and the units were terminated. They no longer existed. Some of them reformed after that, back in their original status. But I had been in law school at the University of Arizona when I got my notice to report to the Army, which was in December of 1940. So I was anxious to get back to law school. I was anxious to see my 2.5-year-old son that I had never seen. So I immediately applied for termination, and it was granted. I then started back to law school and went summers and all and completed it at the University of Colorado. I got my degree in 1947. Moved to Western Colorado, and the following election, I was elected district attorney over there.
Where was this?
In Delta, Colorado. It's in Western Colorado. I had 7 counties in my district, and I had a private practice of law. I had a law firm. I'd formed a law firm called Sparks, Conklin, and Carroll, 3 of us. And in the private practice, and besides, I was a district attorney. At that time, district attorneys could also have a private practice. That's not the case anymore in Colorado. Now, district attorneys are full-time. Well, I practiced there for 10 years or so, and then was appointed to the Colorado Supreme Court as a justice in the Colorado Supreme Court. served out an unexpired term if one of the justices had died. And then I had various, I became a special assistant attorney general for the state of Colorado and was sort of a lobbyist for the state of Colorado in Washington for about 20 years. And retired about in 1979.
You retired from?
I retired, I got, after I got out of the service, I was in the reserves. And then I decided I had never been in the National Guard, but I had served with the National Guard regiment in the whole war. So I joined the National Guard here in Colorado. I ended up as the commanding general of the Colorado Army National Guard and retired from that in 1977. In 1979, I retired from everything.
Well, let me go back a little. You came back to the U.S. in 45 and reunited with your wife and child. Were there other children born?
Well, later, yeah, there were. About 10 months after I got back, our oldest daughter was born.
And her name?
Jean Ann. She lives here in Lakewood now. Got three children of her own. And then 2 or 3 years later, a son was born.
And his name?
Scott. And then a couple of years later, my last child was born, a daughter, Kim. All of them are here in the metropolitan area. We now have 6 grandchildren.
Maybe we'll stop the tape here and continue on the next one. Tape 6, September 17, 1996. Interviewee is General Felix Sparks. Interviewer, Tony Catch Binstock. Being done in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America, and is being done in English. General Sparks, you were telling us about your children and some of your grandchildren. You said your children live all around Denver.
Yes. Well, not all of them. We have one granddaughter who lives in Milwaukee. I have one grandson who's now in the Army, but he'll be home this month and starting college right away. All of my 4 children served in the military, but none of them cared for it very much. And they all spent 1 enlistment, either in the Army or in the Navy. 2 of my grandsons, one spent an enlistment in the Air Force. He just graduated from college this year. The other one's in the Army. He'll be getting out this month. He completes his 4 years, and he'll be starting college. So practically all of my kids and part of my grandchildren have had some type of military service in either the Army, Navy, or Air Force. But none of them cared for it, and I didn't care for it either as a steady diet. Although I spent 8 years on active duty, I didn't want to make a career out of it, although I practically did. Because I got called back once after the end of World War II. When I got so busy with my civilian occupation, I was a director of natural resources for the state of Colorado for a while, the director of the State Water Conservation Board. And so I was always busy in addition to my National Guard duties. So I had time to get promoted to Brigadier General, I had to attend the Army War College at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. That's called the Army Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, the Army War College at Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and the National War College at Fort McNair, Washington, D.C. So I've been a part-time soldier or full-time soldier almost all of my life, and racked up a total of over 15 years of what was called active duty. Since I retired from both the military in 77 and civilian job in 79, my wife and I decided we were pretty well off financially, and we decided we'd see the world. So we have traveled extensively throughout Europe and Pacific since I retired until a little over 3 years ago. We got the worst shock of our lives. One of our 16-year-old grandson, who was a twin boys, was killed in a drive-by shooting by some kid that he didn't even know. He wasn't the intended target, but he's the one who died. Well, the kid that killed him was 15 years old. And at that time, we had no law whatsoever regarding juveniles and handguns. A kid 10 years old could pack a gun around, and they were doing it. We were having, in a particular summer that my grandson was killed, there were something like 20 juveniles who were killed by handguns. So I helped them. I decided I wasn't going to sit around and grieve about my grandson, that I would do something about it. So I got together with some influential people here in Colorado, the district attorney's office in Denver, and some others, and we formed an organization called PUNCH, Parents United, No Children's Handguns. And we met with the governor, and he agreed to call a special session of the legislature that year to consider making it a crime for juveniles under the age of 18 to be carrying handguns. The special session was called in September of 1993, 6 months after my grandson was killed. And the legislature adopted one of the toughest measures in the United States on juveniles and handguns. But our organization, PUNCH, we raised about $50,000 to put on a campaign, a statewide campaign to influence legislators to enact that legislation. My wife and I put in about half of that, but about $25,000 that we spent on that effort, and we're continuing that effort today as far as juveniles and handguns are concerned. We're, of course, always opposed by the National Rifle Association, which believes that everybody should be free to kill everybody, as far as I can understand their philosophy. But despite that, it's a very formidable organization and has a good many million dollars a year in revenues, we were able here in Colorado to adopt a rather strict law. And since that time, over 200 kids have been picked up and charged with carrying handguns, very often in the schools. So we're making some headway, but the way society is today, who knows? Money talks big, and the gun industry is a $1 billion-a-year industry. So the people making money from that source don't like to have any impediment put in the way of their selling guns to who they don't care, as long as they can sell guns. Well, that took a lot of our energy away. We have not, and a lot of our money and time. And we have not traveled hardly any since that day. We do no more overseas travel. All we do is I get together with our annual reunion every year. I arrange for that and conduct it. But so life has its ups and downs. Every family has tragedies, and ours has had a great tragedy. But thousands of other families have experienced the same thing.
You were talking about your 15 years military service. You said you were called back into the service after World War II.
Yes.
What was that campaign, or what was that?
It was that Cuba, Berlin deal. I was called back as a STRAC commander. At that time, I was a full colonel. And was one assigned to the forces that were selected to make the invasion of Cuba. But as you know, when Khrushchev backed down and agreed to take the missiles out of Cuba, that thing ended. So I was only in for a year. But it did take a year out that I had not expected.
Were you also in the Korean?
No. Strangely enough, the unit I was with at that time was not called for the Korean duty. I was with an infantry regiment, but it was not called. Although other troops from the Colorado National Guard were called, our air wing and medical battalion, tank battalion, were all called to Korea.
And have you made any trips? You said you and your wife went, did a lot of traveling. Did you ever go back to Germany or to Dachau?
We've been back to Germany about five times since the end of the war. Three of those trips included a visit to Dachau. I met with some survivors, German survivors, who were in Dachau when we arrived. They were political prisoners. And I've gone through their museum there about three times since the end of the war. The present German government has maintained a small museum at Dachau, and every time I've been there, I've been surprised at the great number of tourists who go through that grim facility on a daily basis. Now, practically everything has been torn down there, but they have maintained two or three of those barracks, but they have been rebuilt. But they have exhibits, the pictures, some of the tortures, and they have a movie which they show in the museum, which is in the old prison area itself.
In the inmates, that part?
Yes. The outside is no longer open to the public. Just where the prison area was is open to the public. While the crematoriums are still there, they're just outside of the prison area, but you can go through the crematoriums and the other buildings that were used to pile in the dead people. And then the museum itself. So it's maintained by the German government at this time. A number of my men have been back there also, the men that I served with. On two occasions, we took members of our regimental association and their wives. The other time, I was by myself. So my wife has been there twice. But we have visited Germany at least five times in our travels of Europe, and we've been to most of the European countries except the part that was under the Russian domination. We've never been to any of those. My last visit to Dachau was just 3 years ago.
What was that occasion?
Well, a group here headed by our lieutenant governor, small group of people, wanted to explore. We were having a problem with neo-Nazis here in this country, as you know, and people who put out false propaganda. So a small group of us headed by our lieutenant governor, several Jewish people, also one Arabic type, Japanese, Chinese. We had an ethnic mix. We wanted to explore what the German government is doing about their neo-Nazi movement. So we had a chance to meet with German officials and with the American embassy in Bonn, Germany, and then go on to Munich and go through the museum at Dachau. A very rewarding visit, I think. We learned a lot about the problems that the Germans are having today. And they're having a neo-Nazi movement. We have the same thing here in the United States. What caught our attention was that in the Holocaust memorial services that we have here every year, we begin to have people picket with signs saying this is all a hoax. The Holocaust is a hoax. And then more disturbing to me was a few years ago, about 2 years ago, I was speaking in San Diego as a guest of the Marine base at Camp Pendleton, California. And one of the people in the audience, the public was invited, one of the people in the audience came up to me and showed me a leaflet. I have copies of it here, which anyway is put out by an outfit called a Historical Institute of Costa Mesa, California. And they put out a pamphlet which says, has a bunch of questions and answers, which in effect states that the Holocaust never happened. In that literature, it says that no Jews were killed in concentration camps. That was all made up. And that the crematoriums and the concentration camps still exist over there were constructed after the war as tourist attractions. Well, you have to be sick, very sick, to come out and preach today that the Holocaust never happened. And these are people with great hatreds. Obviously, they're neo-Nazi type, they're Hitler worshippers. So I've done my best to try to dispel the idea that it never happened. And not only me, but there were thousands of American soldiers, British soldiers, Russian soldiers. Dachau was one of hundreds of concentration camps that the Germans maintained. So there were thousands of British, American, and Russian soldiers who liberated those camps who saw firsthand. And thousands of pictures were taken. To say that it never happened is the height of stupidity and viciousness. So I'll fight those type of people to my last breath. I have great sympathy for the Jewish people who I have no question that something like 6 million died in concentration camps, but there are also, in addition to the Jewish people, there were others who died as well. The inmates at Dachau when we arrived, actually the bulk of them were Russians, Russian civilians. And the next biggest group was Polish, and the next biggest group was Jewish.
Did you know how many numbers there were of each?
Yes, we took an inventory of the number of people by races. And we have that inventory. I have that inventory. Almost 32,000, but there were 25 or 30 different races represented. There were some Italians, there were French, Lithuanians, you name it, and some Americans. But they were naturalized Americans who apparently were caught back when they went back to visit their home areas. I think there were five or six who were naturalized Americans.
Did you ever see or talk with them?
No, I never talked. I talked to one. He was actually an American soldier who was a member of the OSS, which at that time was our equivalent of the agency, the spy agency, the CIA. And he had been dropped into Germany as some kind of mission and been captured. And he told me that he'd only been there a short time, and he was the only actually American that was in there. He was a lieutenant, an American lieutenant. I talked to him very briefly.
Do you remember his name?
Yeah, he had a French name. He spoke French and German. He was from Chicago. I have been able to trace him down since then, but he's died. I can't remember. He had a French name. I can't remember it offhand. And I'm not sure about his story either, because when he first came to my attention was right after we arrived. He came up to the gate and was shouting, "I'm an American soldier." So I said to the guards, "Let him out." He came out, and he told me he was a major. Oh, something like Giroux was his name, something like that, Rene Giroux. And he told me he was an American major, an OSS. Well, I thought he was, but I found out later his testimony is in here, in this book, and now he turns out to be a first lieutenant. not a major at all, so I'm not sure about his story, how he got there. But his testimony is in this book that I have. Some peculiar things happened there. That was always a mystery to me, why he told me he was a major. And he paraded around as a major there for 2 or 3 days. But when it came down to giving testimony, he admitted he was a first lieutenant. Crazy.
Has what you experienced at the Liberation affected your attitudes and values?
Well, I suppose one thing, it was the most terrible lesson you could ever get in discrimination. When I speak at high schools and other places today, I say discrimination is one of the world's greatest evils, responsible for millions of deaths. And I point out that none of us have a choice of what religion or what race we belong to. None of us volunteered to come into this world. So you're stuck with whatever you happen to be, whether you're a Muslim or a Catholic or Baptist or black or white. No one could help it. So why should we discriminate against people who had no choice about what their color or race or religion is? And I think when you see those concentration camps, you see discrimination at the lowest depth of degradation. One thing that I've never seen mentioned, hardly at all, is the fact that there was another group of people who were discriminated against even worse than the Jewish people were, and those were the gypsies. The gypsies were rounded up and exterminated offhand in Germany. I mean, they were just... many of the Jewish people, at least the younger Jewish men, served in labor camps. So thousands of them survived by serving in the labor camps. The policy in Nazi Germany was for women and children to be executed promptly. They were considered worthless. There were no children in Dachau. And the older people were singled out for extermination. But many of the younger group, you say from 16 to 30, survived because they were put in labor camps, although many younger ones also were killed in the concentration camps at Auschwitz and Buchenwald are two of the worst that come to mind. But the gypsies, they weren't even put in labor camps. They were just killed out of hand. But there's nobody to speak for the gypsies, you see. They have no nation, no country. So nobody ever hardly mentions the gypsies. But when you look at the Nazi records, that was a group that was discriminated against terribly and executed promptly. They didn't go to labor camps or anything. There weren't a great number of them, but nobody knows how many, but it was many thousand. And one religion that I found out in all the books I read about Dachau were discriminated against the same way was Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, that was a very, very small group in Germany, but they were considered in the same light as the gypsies, and probably only a few hundred of them, but they were promptly executed along with the gypsies. Because we have Jehovah's Witnesses in this country, it's a fairly large organization, but they had a small organization in Germany. The other group of religion that was discriminated against by the Germans were the Catholics. Catholic priests were simply rounded up, and they were part of the original group that was sent to Dachau starting in 1933. And when they invaded Poland and took over Poland, the Catholic priests, most of them went to Dachau. So that was another group. But they did not, there appears no record of actual extermination of the priests. There were some executed, but because they got rebellious, but even the Lutheran, which is Germany's predominant Lutheran, Pastor Niemöller, was one of the leaders of the Lutheran Church in Germany in Berlin. He finally spoke out against Hitler, and he was put in Dachau. Now, he and some of the other important prisoners that were in Dachau were taken out of Dachau several weeks before we arrived. They were not there. Those are the ones that, that Marguerite Higgins was looking for, were not there. We found out they had been moved to Austria before we arrived. And Pastor Niemöller survived the war. I remember he, in some of his remembrances, I've seen some of his writings, he said something about, they persecuted the Jews, and I said nothing. They persecuted the labor unions, and I said nothing. And then they came for me. He made an observation, something like that. But he did speak out, and that's the reason they came for him. But he survived, and there apparently was no systematic execution of priests of various religions, although some were executed in the records for trying to lead a rebellion or speaking out, even when they're in prison camp.
And how about homosexuals? Did you see any records of...
Yes. Homosexuals were also discriminated against, and... In our classification of prisoners, we did not try to identify those, if there were any, and I presume there were some. But I know they had a special marking. See, each prisoner was supposed to have a special marking on an emblem on his shoulder. The Jewish would have the Star of David and various insignia were attached. Homosexuals had their own insignia, but if there were any in Dachau, I never knew about it. And apparently it was not an intensive drive, as near as I can gather, because Ernest Rome, who was the head of the Brown Shirts, the organization that put Hitler into power, was a homosexual. Hitler had him killed, but not because he was homosexual, because he wanted him out of the way, because he considered Ernest Rome too powerful. Ernest Rome, the Brown Shirts, was a civilian organization who were supported by German industrialists, Krupp and so on. They wanted to get rid of the Versailles Treaty and rearm Germany. And Hitler and the Brown Shirts were their avenue to do that. Well, the Brown Shirts were well equipped. They were in uniform. They wore a brown uniform. They were well equipped, and they were just like an army, and they were much larger than the German army. So when Hitler came to power, the German general says, we're not going to support you. We can't put up with a civilian army. So Hitler agreed to get rid of the Brown Shirts, but he took many of them with him, of course, like Goebbels and Goring. But Ernest Röhm, who was ahead of the Brown Shirts, Hitler had executed, and in one swoop he took out all the Brown Shirts that he did not like, and they were disbanded. But Hitler double-crossed the generals because they turned around and created the SS outside of the German army.
Were you ever, you saw many of these records, were you ever asked to testify at the Nuremberg trials?
Yes, I was. But I refused to go. Because at that time I was district attorney over in western Colorado, and I felt that I could not contribute really anything at all, because what I saw, thousands of other people saw and had been photographed. And beside the incident of our killing the German guards, it would not look good on cross-examination. So I refused to go, and of course they had no jurisdiction over me at all. I'm an American citizen here in this country. War Crimes Tribunal had no jurisdiction over me.
Were you subpoenaed or just requested?
I got a subpoena from the United States Marshal.
Okay, I think we'll end this tape and begin the next one. September 17th, 1996. The interviewee is General Felix Sparks. The interviewer, Tony Catch Binstock, in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America, and is being done in English. I think at the end of the last tape we were talking about that you did not choose to participate in the Nuremberg trials.
Yes.
And you said you were back home and you were...
Yeah, I was district attorney in Western Colorado at that time, and I couldn't really have added anything to the Nuremberg trials. And I didn't want to be cross-examined about the killing of those guards. One of the interesting things is there have been a number of books written about Dhaka. I have three or four up here in my library now. And some of them are so outlandish that it's incredible. One book says that we killed, some, I think, 545 German soldiers in Dhaka. Well, it wasn't half that many there when we got there in the first place. The actual body count done by the Inspector General, I believe, was 34. And some of those were not killed by American soldiers. Some were killed by these camp trustees, I call them, the inmates. There were, of course, armament everywhere, rifles. The Germans dropped their rifles. And the inmates killed probably four or five of the 34 because... until we got them stopped, because they were going to kill every German they could find. And they probably killed maybe four or five, half, I don't know how many, half dozen of the 34 who were killed. But the Inspector General, in that report that he made, was very meticulous. And he even counted the bullet holes in the wall where my machine gunner killed those 11. The number he puts is higher than 11, but what happened was the prisoners themselves caught some Germans and took them to that place and killed them there. But my machine gunner actually killed about 11. But the numbers vary according to who wrote the book. The highest number I've seen is in a book I have here, is I think 545. That's a far fetch from 34. But other books also have equally high numbers of German soldiers who were killed there. The true number is 34. I don't care if there was 500. If we'd have killed 500, I would say so. There's no reason for me to worry about how many were killed there. But I was there. And why they come? I think a lot of these authors, in order to embellish their book, have to exaggerate their numbers. I find that quite common among authors who weren't there but who are writing about historic events. They want to embellish their story, and I'm sure that's the case. Some of these books are more or less factual, but none of them are accurate. But anyway, I was always intrigued by all these books that said how many we'd killed, and I knew it wasn't the case, but immediately after the armistice was declared, which was about May 8th, I guess, officially it was, a few days after Dhaka. We started, the Allied forces started rounding up all the SS officers because many were wanted for known atrocities, the Malmedy massacre during the Battle of the Bulge where American soldiers were lined up and killed. We had the names of some of those officers from witnesses, SS officers. You never found the regular German army doing things like this. It was always the SS. And they were wanted for a great number of atrocities, so we rounded up all we could find. And they were brought to Dachau. And they were kept there in a special confinement area was constructed. And all were examined then by Allied examiners to determine which ones were responsible for various things. Most of them were turned loose, but those that we could identify were tried and charged and executed as a result of the Nuremberg trials. But I was always intrigued by all these stories and what happened at Dhaka. So in 1988, through a friend, I arranged for an interview for a German SS captain in Germany. Well, my wife and I and another couple, four of us, went to Germany, and we met this SS officer in Trier, Germany. He could speak pretty good English, so I got to spend about a full day with him, going over the war and how he felt about it, and I asked him about the story that we had lined up all those people and killed everybody at that wall. He said, well, no. He said, a friend of mine was a lieutenant in that group, and he wasn't hurt. But he said, he was there, and he witnessed it. He said, an American officer stopped it. Well, that was me. Anyway, I had a long interview with this German officer, former officer. What I was interested in to see if he was any way repentant. And he was very straightforward. But I could tell from several hours we spent together in a little lodge up in the mountains out of Trier that he wasn't a damn bit repentant. It was apparent to me that the only thing he was sorry about was that they got beat. But it was an interesting experience. I have received some letters from some SS officers since who participated in various battles that we were in. In any event, not many of the SS people were repentant about anything. It was a special group of people, and they were tough soldiers. They were fanatical. But I don't think many people realize that we rounded them all up and incarcerated them and grilled them all, and practically all of them were turned loose eventually, but they were kept prisoners for some period of time there, right out near Dachau. So some of the post-war things that I found out are quite interesting. Let's say particularly this file that I have here where that Inspector General, I didn't realize that he'd counted the bullet holes in the wall, and he has each one marked where those 11 that I know of were killed there. So I have studied, I've read everything I could find on it. Some of the books are in foreign tongue that I can't read. They've been given to me by. Another thing that I did not realize was the extent to which the French cooperated with the Germans in concentration camps. That's been downplayed, but there were concentration camps in France that were manned by Frenchmen, although the overseers were Gestapo. But the Vichy government cooperated fully in rounding up the Jews in France. And of course, the French today are still after some of the, you got a trial of various people. I have had an opportunity to talk to a great number of people. I've traveled in various states, Texas, Oklahoma, Wyoming, Utah, California, and spoken to various groups. And one thing I found out last year, I was in San Antonio, Texas. I met a professor, an American professor, who was teaching at Emory University in Atlanta. And he said, General, I bet you don't know that there was one country that refused to cooperate with Hitler. And I said, no, I never heard of that. Well, it turned out this professor was from Bulgaria. Now, Bulgaria was an Axis partner. All the Balkan states were. Czechoslovakia was forced into it, but Hungary and Romania and Bulgaria were all full partners with Hitler. And he said that Hitler issued an order to the king of Bulgaria that 25,000 Jews, they always set a quota, I found out, in Italy and wherever, that they were to send into Germany for extermination. And the Bulgarian king refused to do it. And they have a parliament in Bulgaria, and the parliament refused. So the king was ordered to go to Berlin. He went, came back, and died very mysteriously several days later. Bulgarians say he was poisoned somehow or other. But then Hitler he lowered the demand from 25,000 to 20,000, and the Bulgarians still refused. And Hitler didn't do anything about it. So Bulgaria was apparently the only country that refused to round up any Jews. And I found out in Italy, they got a quota the same way, but the Italians, while they sent quite a few Jews, they didn't round them up the way Hitler ordered them to. They would always make an excuse they didn't have the transport for. They use the word transport over there for the trains, you know. And the Italians drug their feet a lot. And so not many Jews were taken out of Italy. Mussolini wasn't much in favor of taking the Jews out for extermination.
So you learned a lot about this after the war that you didn't know before.
Oh, yeah. Well, I didn't know anything about concentration camps before the war. Only after the war and the various travels that I have made to countries of Europe and meeting with people who are in those countries or prisoners or like this Bulgarian professor who migrated to the United States and is now a professor at Emory University in Atlanta.
You go all over the country then speaking, it sounds like.
Yes.
Are you invited to talk about the Holocaust in that way?
Yes. High schools and the military reservations. The military has been active. I've been spoken in three different military reservations, California, Colorado, and Texas, the military posts. They have a Holocaust memorial at these posts. And I've been to one in Utah, California, Colorado, and Texas. And then a number of high schools here and in Wyoming.
Do you speak to a particular group, the Anti-Defamation League?
It's usually they have an assembly at these schools, and I'm sometimes I do it two or three times to different groups of students, different classes. But I'm getting a little old for that anymore. I'm going to have to cut it down, and my health hasn't been good. But I have learned a tremendous lot about mankind since I suppose you can't believe it until you see it. It's difficult to describe. Because most people say, well, it couldn't have happened. Well, it did happen. And I might have been among the doubters. I don't know if I hadn't seen it with my own eyes.
Did your experiences there affect your religious belief in any way?
No, but I think one thing that I learned, and I've had some contacts with Muslims, we live in a difficult world as far as religion is concerned. There are a great number of religions, and some major. I was surprised to find out that the Muslim religion is the world's largest. I didn't realize that Indonesia and some of those countries are Muslim. But it's the largest, world's largest religion. So they believe in that religion as devoutly as we might believe in the Jewish or the Protestant religion. So it's hard to condemn people. And you got two or three different prominent religions in India, the Hindu, and they got different groups over there killing each other. I suppose when you look at the history of the world, religion has been responsible for more deaths than any other single factor in the history of this world. The Crusades and all profess to be doing the right thing. But they have no hesitancy or killing or condemning somebody who is not of their religion. To me, that is a form of insanity. And the Catholics and the Protestants, even in Ireland, I suppose it's something that will go on to the end of time. I don't know. But I see no signs that the world is getting much more progressive in the way of religious tolerance or racial tolerance. Yeah, we're making some improvements, but we have a long way to go.
Did your experience in Germany and talking to this SS officer, did that change your feeling, or what are your feelings about the German people of your generation or the younger generation?
Well, I found a lot of Germans are very contrite about the whole Holocaust experience. I remember right after we took Munich, some German, I assume, had written on one of the public buildings downtown there, "I am ashamed to be a German." And the Bavarian people were never really hip on Hitler. That at one time was an independent kingdom, of course, and Hitler had a lot of opposition in Bavaria, and the center of it was Munich. So you find even today, a lot of contrite people. But on the other hand, many who are not. I was interested. We met with the city council of Dachau here in 1993 when I was over there. We had a chance to meet with the Bavarian, or the city council of Dachau. Now, Dachau is a fairly sizable city, maybe 35,000 people, something like that. And at one time, it was quite an art center, a cultural center in Germany, way back in the medieval period. So it's in a very old city. And they deeply resent the fact that the concentration camp bears the name of their city, very resentful of that fact. Said, "We don't know why we get blamed for Dachau. We had nothing to do with it. It was an old military installation, I think, with the munitions factory during World War II. That area with Dachau, and the Germans put that concentration camp there. And the present citizens of Dachau are very resentful." There's an interesting sidelight. After we took the camp, the citizens of Dachau said, "Well, we don't know anything about what was going on in there." Well, it's true, they weren't allowed in there. But there were numerous German soldiers who were partying in Dachau all the time, getting drunk. So they would have had some knowledge, and they saw thousands of people going in there and none coming out. But it's true, they had no real personal knowledge. So we rounded up all the citizens we could find in Dachau and made them go through Dachau. And we made them help bury the bodies. You see, we had so many thousand bodies, not only in Dachau, but on the outskirts. Just about 2 or 3 weeks before the end of the war, Heinrich Himmler, the head of the Gestapo and the SS, one of the cruelest men that ever lived, sent out an order. I have a copy of it somewhere, but it says, and it was directed to all the commandants of the concentration camps. And the order said, you're not to allow any of the inmates to fall into the hands of Allied troops. Well, how could they help it? But they were frantic, so they were moving people around like crazy. That's how that train came in from Buchenwald. Buchenwald commander, Buchenwald was overrun by Patton's Third Army before we took Dachau, about a week or so before. So the commandant of Buchenwald moved a bunch of people and tried to get rid of a bunch. But how could they get rid of thousands of people? They couldn't do it. Dachau, the commandant, went crazy, and he started marching. We don't know how many thousand, but anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 that were there. He started marching them towards Austria, and most of them died. So we were policing up bodies for miles around, and it turned out we had something like 9,000 dead bodies. So how do you handle that many dead? You can't. But we made the citizens of Dachau help with the burial. And we just took bulldozers and dug deep trenches and tried to identify people with numbers or whatever we could, any way to identify them. Many you could not identify. And buried them in mass burials. But the people of DACA was made to witness and to help out with that, you see.
What was their reaction to that?
Well, many of them were cried, saying that, well, they didn't know, they weren't part of it, they didn't know anything about it, which is to a great extent true. The trouble with, when you get an absolute dictatorship that takes over a country and they take over the police, the ordinary citizen becomes relatively helpless. They're caught. And not much they could do. And if they did do anything, if they were apprehended, then they were put in a concentration camp or executed. So when the system gets so vicious that the average citizen can do nothing about it, they're really trapped. And then really not much they can do. They can't vote. They can't do anything. They just become part of the system. This is true of any absolute dictatorship. The people become helpless. But they allow it to happen in the first instance. That's, but again, they're rather powerless because suddenly you create a... Hitler was elected. Well, he wasn't really elected. Germany had free elections. And Hitler was not elected. He came out second. And the von Hindenburg party... won the election. Von Hindenburg was the president of Germany, but the chancellor is the guy who runs it. So Hitler failed in the general election. But the Brown Shirts then got active, and they pressured everybody, and von Hindenburg appointed Hitler as a chancellor, so he was never elected as a chancellor. And the minute that was done, it was all over. So it was not a free election.
Have you told, you've talked to groups, have you told your children and your grandchildren about your experiences?
Yes, some.
And have you ever been interviewed by any other oral history projects?
Oh, yes. I say oral history. I've appeared in several television films. There was a British crew came here about 3 years ago from London, and they put out a film called Nightmare's End. It was shown on the Discovery Channel. I was one of the people interviewed for that. Then a Japanese crew came in about 2 or 3 years ago also. There was a Japanese battalion that claimed they liberated Dachau, an artillery battalion. Well, in the first place, artillery battalions don't go around liberating anything. They follow up. But they claimed to have liberated Dachau, and they claimed that they were told that they couldn't tell anybody that they had... it appeared in the newspapers on the West Coast. They had a big reunion in San Francisco. And one of these guys, Japanese soldiers, said... They were American soldiers, but they were Japanese ancestry. How he met with Cardinal Niemöller, when Niemöller wasn't even there, and how they rescued all these people. They weren't there at all. It's true, they were in another corps, which was off on our right, that was headed towards Austria. And what they ran into was this group that was being marched out of Dachau, see. Anyway, they... crew was here to try to establish, and I disabused them of that in a hurry, I think. But they put out a film on it, and they sent me a copy of it, but it won't fit my thing in here. But they gave me this watch. It's a Japanese watch I've never heard of, but it's been running good ever since, anyway. We did that in the backyard out here in the summertime.
Looking back at what you experienced and witnessed, is there anything that you would like to say to future generations?
Well, the only thing I can tell future generations is to try to eliminate hatred and prejudice and intolerance for various groups and various races and various religions. Let everybody live their own life. That's my message. And respect their religion or their race. I don't agree with the Muslim religion or the Buddhist either, but I respect they believe in it, and they may be right. none of us know. That's the problem. We're convinced that we're either Jewish or Christian, that we have the only religion, the only true religion. Well, other people feel the same way about their religion. So I am not going to criticize them because they don't feel the same way that I do. And that's the message I try to get across in the speeches that I make. Race, religion, or intolerance has no place in this world. And I say we've made a lot of strides, but we're far from perfect in that field and probably never will be.
And you speak to Holocaust memorials, and where all have you been, and have you been honored?
Well, I spoke at the dedication of the Holocaust Museum, I guess it was last year. I was one of the four speakers who spoke at that. They had a tremendous event there. That is a tremendous institution, that Holocaust Memorial Museum. I was amazed at what a tremendous amount of work and money that has gone to constructing that museum. It's right in downtown Washington, and it's run by the National Park Service. And if you want to see that, it takes a good 3 or 4 hours. You got to last, I would say, not less than 3 hours to see all the exhibits that they have there. And anybody who says it didn't happen goes through that museum, I don't know how they can say that all that was fabricated. You know, your mind has got to go take a crazy turn to believe that it never happened. So, I don't know. But I talked to one of the museum people last week. They want this book that I have here, this record, and which I will send to them. And he told me that they're still getting well over 1,000 people a day, every day, through that museum. And it's run by the National Park Service. And it's sustained, by the federal government. But they do, I think they charge admission. Yeah, they do charge admission there.
I think we'll stop this tape and start another.
Well, I don't know of anything else we can cover.
November 17th, 1996, interviewee General Felix Sparks, interviewer Tony Catch Binstock in Lakewood, Colorado, United States of America, and it's being done in English. At the end of the last tape, General, you said you didn't think there was anything more. Is there anything else that you wanted to add or that I've forgotten to ask you about?
No, I can't think of anything. There is a lady here, I think she's still alive, can't think of her name offhand, but I have met with her a couple of times, lives out, I believe, in Englewood or Littleton, who was a reporter at the war crimes trial.
Vivian Spitz, I believe.
Yeah, Vivian, that's her name. And she has a wealth of information because she has a lot of the exhibits she kept. She went through that whole trial. You know, that trial, people don't realize it, but those trials lasted for 5 years. That trial lasted for 5 years. And it went through different groups. Nazi doctors. I have a book here about the Nazi doctors and the various groups. It started with a head group. They didn't get Goebbels. He committed suicide. But the fat boy, Hermann Goering, was tried. That group, the leadership was tried first, and after that they broke that into a number of different categories. like the Nazi doctors. The professors, one of the interesting things about the German mentality, this Dr. Rascher, who was the guy who conducted, I think, the high altitude and the freezing experiments at Dachau, his wife apparently was not able to bear children. Well, Hitler, of course, you got a medal in Germany. If you had so many kids, you got a boys, they didn't count girls. So many boys, you got a bronze medal, so many more, a silver medal, and a gold medal. Those were given out for wives. But apparently, Dr. Rascher's wife was not able to conceive. So she got a child from some source, baby. Could have gotten it out of the concentration camp, because women had, if they weren't executed promptly, some women had babies in the concentration camp. Anyway, she passed it off as their own, and she named Heinrich Himmler as the godfather. And Himmler visited him, because he was carrying on his experiments at Dachau. And I have some of her letters that she had written to him, or he had written to her. And one later, she expressed her great appreciation for his visit his godchild. Well, somehow or other, somebody discovered that she didn't really have that baby. Well, that made old Himmler mad to no end. So her husband, Dr. Rascher, was executed at Dachau. He was hung. And she was executed. That's how far they carried their ideological things. So he would have been executed anyway as a result of the war time. Dr. Schilling, who was the one that constructed the experiments on various diseases, malaria and so on, he was apprehended after the war, and he was executed. He was one of the German doctors that was executed. But Rascher escaped the execution, American execution. The Germans executed him because of the false identity. That's how far they carried the things. You know, it's incredible.
One thing I did forget to ask is what kind of medals that you were given during the...
Oh, I was wounded twice, so I got 2 Purple Hearts. I got 2 Silver Stars and Meritorious Service Medal, the Legion of Merit. And from the French government, I got the French Croix de Guerre. I don't know, Mr. I never paid much attention to medals. I don't even know where they are. I got them around here somewhere.
Well, General Sparks, it has been an honor to interview you. And thank you so much for participating in the Shoah Project.
Well, I don't know what you're going to do with all this. I did meet old Steven Spielberg at the governor's mansion here a year or so ago. He's a very ordinary looking and talking guy, you know, when you just meet him.
General Sparks, will you introduce your wife to us?
Well, please? This is my wife, Mary, my wife of some 55 years and the mother of our 4 children. We met while we were students at the University of Arizona when we were both freshmen. She graduated from the University of Arizona. We were married while she, at the end of her junior year, and I was in the Army at that time. It was in June of 1941. Little did we realize that about 6 months later, or 8 months later, Pearl Harbor would come along and change our lives rather drastically. So we didn't see much of each other in our first years of marriage. I was overseas for 2.5 years. And she had a baby about the time that I was departing for Africa. And I didn't see the baby, a little boy, until he was about 2.5 years old. But it's been a long, hectic 55 years, but very rewarding.
Mrs. Sparks, do you have anything you'd like to say?
Well, I will say that over all these years, it's been anything but dull.
Did his war experiences and what he's participated in since then, how did that affect your life?
Well, it affected it a lot, you know. Like, he's had all kinds of experiences and parts to his life that I was included in.
Well, thank you very, very much, both of you, for appearing today. What is this picture, please?
That's a picture taken at Fort Kamehameha, Hawaii. I was a corporal at that time and a member of an artillery regiment, which was was supposed to be protecting Pearl Harbor. We were actually at the mouth of Pearl Harbor, and we manned big guns. We were still anticipating invasions by land in those days, and we did not anticipate the invasion by air that actually occurred. My old regiment never fired a shot when the Japanese hit Pearl Harbor.
Thank you. And what is this picture, please?
That's a picture taken in Washington, D.C. in about 1939. At that time, the United States used to be divided into nine core areas. And annually, an award was given to the outstanding military cadet in each of the core areas, the nine core areas. This was a General Pershing Award. And the medal is being presented to the nine of us by General George Marshall, who at that time was the Army Chief of Staff.
And which one are you?
I'm in the back row there, in the middle in the back row, the tallest one you can see in the back row. We were awarded a 3-day trip to Washington, D.C., all expenses paid, and we were entertained very royally while we were in Washington, D.C.
Is General Marshall in that picture?
General Marshall's there. He's the one presenting the medal. Oh, he's over here on the end. That's General Marshall right there. He pinned on the medal on each one of us. Of course.
And this picture?
Well, that's a wedding picture of my wife and I taken on June 17th, 1941 at Tucson, Arizona. I had been called back to the service at that time, was a second lieutenant. She was a student at the University of Arizona, and her family lived in Tucson, Arizona, where we were married.
Okay. And this picture?
That's a picture taken on the NGO beachhead. This is Colonel Krieger on the left and me on the right. He was the battalion commander at that time, and I was the battalion executive officer. Subsequently, both he and I were battalion commanders all through the French and German campaigns. He was a very, very fine officer. Unfortunately, passed away earlier this year.
When was this taken?
It was taken in 1961 when I was called back to active duty as the commander of an artillery group of four artillery battalions that were scheduled to take place in the invasion of Cuba if it occurred. I was designated as a STRAC commander, and this was at Fort Sill, Oklahoma.
What year was that?
1961.
And this picture?
That picture was taken at my retirement ceremony at Fort Carson in 1977. And at that time, I was presented with the Legion of Merit Award. And on that day, I retired from the Army.
What was your rank?
I was a Brigadier General at that time.
And this?
That book, Sparks, was written by Imogene Beekner of New Orleans, Louisiana. Her husband was my battalion surgeon, medical doctor, in France and Germany. And what she did was take all of my memoirs that I had written about the various battles, and it covers my whole 5-year period as a member of the 157th Infantry Regiment.
And the pictures that we looked at before?
Yeah, the pictures that you saw before were all in that book. I'll have to look at this one. I can see better.
And who's in this picture?
Well, that picture was taken on the occasion of our 50th wedding anniversary here in Lakewood about 5 years ago now. And the picture was presented to us by our children, who gave us this little private party just for our family. And in the back row, starting over on the left? Yeah, on the left, would be our oldest son. He was the one who was born. I didn't see him until he was 2.5 years old. Next to him is his son. His name is Kirk. The next to him is his son, Spencer, who is now in the United States Army and be home pretty quick. And the next one is his other son, Blair, named after his grandmother. My wife's maiden name was Blair. He served 4 years in the United States Air Force. And the other is one of our twin grandsons, Steve, a daughter, the children of our daughter Kim is in the next row. Next to him is the other grandson, one of them was murdered 3 years ago, Lee. And then starting on the extreme left, right over there is our youngest son, Scott. Next to him is Kim, the mother of the two twin boys. And next to her is one of our granddaughters, the daughter of Natalie is her name. And next to her is her mother, Jean Ann, is our oldest daughter. And then going down the line there, that's her other daughter, Tamara. She has those two daughters. And then next to her is a Korean wife of our son, Kirk. He met her while he was stationed in Korea, and they were married there.
And her name?
Her name is Hucha. And then, of course, my wife and I, the older people there.
Very nice, thank you. Okay.
Those pictures were taken by a soldier, an artilleryman, who was attached to my battalion. The man's name was Ed Gorak. He was quite an ardent photographer. He was one of the, since being in the artillery, he could carry a camera when most of the infantrymen could not. But he took great many pictures while we were overseas, and he took these shortly after the liberation of Dachau. And he blew those up for me and sent me those pictures. The top row is all portrays the victims in the railway cars that were at the edge of Dachau, the concentration camp, when we first went in. See, there's a rather young lady in that middle picture was dead in one of those railway cars. The second row there are pictures taken at the crematorium. And one of the pictures on the end is where they had hauled the bodies, stripped of clothing, and they were stacked there ready to be put into the furnaces. Those are prisoners, camp inmates, who posed for these pictures and showed us how it was done. But they were the ones who were compelled to handle all the bodies and put them into the crematorium, where they were then reduced to ashes. There were four of those furnaces. They were coal-fired furnaces.
Okay.
The bottom row, one on the extreme right there, is another picture of the coal-fired furnaces where they cremated the bodies.
The left or the right?
Well, on the end, it shows the furnaces. The middle picture shows an area where they stripped the corpses of all the clothing and took out any silver or gold fillings that they had on their teeth. Then they hung those clothes up in a rack there and they issued them to the other inmates. They never wasted any clothing, but they stripped all the dead of all clothing before they cremated them, and they had stacks of them hanging up there in that building. The end, picture on the end here is a picture of the confinement area, the prison area, showing the prison barracks, the barbed wire fence, and then a path running right along the barbed wire fence, and then the moat filled with water, which surrounded the camp.
Okay.
That was one of the first sights I saw as I approached the confinement area, the prison area. Those were human bodies, been stripped of clothing. They're inside the prison area. Those are being prepared for hauling to the crematorium for cremation, but the Germans left before they picked those up and cremated them. But there were about 200 dead nude bodies in that location right inside the prison area.
Okay.
That's another picture of much the same scene. Those were bodies of people who had died inside the prison, and they were laid out ready to be hauled out to the crematorium, but they never got around to doing that before we arrived.
Okay.
That was a picture taken showing the bodies inside one of the railway cars that we found at the entrance to the camp. In the 39 railway cars, there were about 2,000 dead people who had died en route from Buchenwald to Dachau. That picture was taken, that is after the cleanup of the bodies started. We started collecting bodies from various locations. Many of them still had their clothing on. There were quite a number who died inside the prison area who were still clothed. And this was part of the cleanup operation. We're carrying them and piling them up for burial. That's a picture of German guards who were killed by one of my men with a machine gun. There are about 11 bodies in that pile. He killed them right there at that location, up against a wall, cement wall. That's taken next to the crematorium. There was a small cement building where they piled the nude bodies in that small room in preparation for putting them through the crematorium.
You did not think this was used as a gas chamber, is that correct?
No, there was a gas chamber there, but it was never used for... That was not the gas chamber.
Oh.
It was never used for extermination. That was a room where they... a collecting point where they collected the bodies, and that was next to the furnaces. He always said when he got to the, he was going to piss on the Rhine River as soon as we got to the Rhine, and that's what he's doing.
Now, who is in this picture?
I don't know. This was given to me by a friend from the Third Army headquarters some years ago. I'd forgotten I had it for years, and I found it there not long ago.
Who's the one on the left, then?
On the left, to an extreme left.
Your left, yes.
It's General Patton.
And what did he say he was going to do?
Well, he said he was going to piss in the Rhine River, and that's what he was doing. He's got it out and going at it there.